Thank you. Well, hey y'all. Hey, happy Friday, everybody. Welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly appreciate you. Y'all do me a favor, please, and thank you. And show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love and affection moving in the right direction, please, and thank you. And also make sure, some of y'all might have forgot. Make sure that you like the video on your way in. And if you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel. Make sure that you click that notification bell and select all so that you don't miss out on a single solitary chapter. These good books we be reading over here, all right? So, with that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing, and I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers, and those of you catching this on the replay. Thank y'all so much for coming back one more time to love up on your girl. Because y'all know I love the way y'all love on me. All right, so let's see who is in the building with us today. I'm scrolling, I'm scrolling, I'm scrolling. Hey, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. Welcome, darling. Happy Friday to you. I appreciate you for being here, darling. Thank you so much. All right, Nordic is in the building. Graham Rising, yes, and you are here. Thank you so much, darling, for being here. I appreciate you. Happy Friday. Happy Friday, Miss Dimples. Thank you so much for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Oh, shit. It's going to be a great stream because Choco Chip is in the building and she has brought the good vibes with her. All right. Honestly, Kay is in the building. I made it. The notifications were notificationing today. Okay, I like that. Yes, thank you so much for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Marva is in the building. Child, you ain't got to be standing by the freezer because I don't think we're going to get too much of that. But I thank you for being here, Marva. Thank you so much, darling. Welcome, welcome. Happy Friday to everybody, y'all. It has been, you know what? I'm going to just say it's been a good week. You know why? Because the universe has continued to extend my life contract, child. I'm still here. I woke up on the right side of the grass this morning. I was feeling good. You know, I got a roof over my head, child, food to put in my belly, coffee to warm my palate. And y'all are here in the speakeasy with me. Shit, it don't get no better than that. You heard me? Well, lottery jackpot would be nice, nice chocolatey icing on top of this beautiful cake. But you know what? I'm grateful for what I got. I'll take it. All right. So listen. Oh, this coffee's so good, y'all. Hazelnut coffee, child. What better way to start the day? I am going to, because this book is 19 chapters. What I'm going to do is I'm going to see how far I get. Because I wrote a number on my time stamp sheet, okay? And what I'll do is I'll probably break this up into two videos, but I mean I'll just take probably like a 10 or 15 minute break and then come right back. That way the videos aren't so long. But yeah, I don't want to do the like the super long one that was 7 hours the other day. Listen, you know, I don't care how cushy your chair is, you sit for a long time, your butt is gonna go numb. Almost said something. Let me be quiet. Stay out of my business, Marva. Right. Y'all know Saki's a freak. I was about to say something real raunchified over here, okay? That's my word, raunchified, child. Listen, I was about to get real explicit right quick about your butt going numb, but I think I'll just keep that to myself. Good googly moogly, child. Listen, all right, so let's get into this thing, child. Let's see what ethic is given today. Chapter 3. Messiah sat in VIP at after hours. The nightclub was filled to capacity, but his eyes were glued on one woman, Morgan. Pause, because y'all know that yesterday when we left off, it was Morgan's birthday party, right? She turned 18. And Messiah had been at her party, but he brought that old hump day ass bitch. He brought that old hump day ass bitch. And so she felt some type of way. So he left. And then Ethic gave her permission to go out and party with her homegirl, Niche. So apparently she's at club after hours. So I hope it's not in the hood, and I hope this child, she can't hear shit. But whatever, we're gonna see. All right. So his eyes were glued on one woman, Morgan. She was putting on a show. His temple throbbed as she swung her long braids and her hips rolled to the beat. Gone was the couture model look she had donned earlier. She was a vixen, one that knew she had every man in the club ogling her. There was a party going on all around him. Shayna and her friends mingled with his people, popping bottles of champagne, but Messiah's mood had been spoiled. The sight of Morgan, half-dressed, garnering the attention of every dude in the building, had him ready to dead something without thinking twice. He told himself it was out of loyalty to Ethic. She wasn't supposed to be out there shaking her ass. He was just being a good soldier, right? Or was it something more? Did the disdain spark from the image of her showing off something that he wanted her to keep a secret? Her beauty was hard to miss, even without her accentuating. She tried so hard with tons of makeup and false lashes, but Messiah noticed it most when he saw her out of her element, like when he popped up at their crib to return her car. Nights like this one, she was too obvious, too loose, and he clenched his jaw in irritation as he saw her bend slightly in front of one of his adversaries while working her derriere with expertise. Clown nigga on the dance floor freaking off. He lucky I don't rob his bitch ass, Messiah thought. You're acting real funny tonight, Shayna said as she sat beside him and extended the blunt she was smoking to him. He pushed her hand away. Fuck out of here, he dismissed. Her eyes followed his to the dance floor and she popped her lips. That retarded ass bitch is the reason you're over here, sour face, she shot. Fuck you just say, he asked, as his face screwed in disgust. He never lost his cool, but she saw the blaze in his eyes. He gripped her by the elbow and grabbed an open bottle of Ace from the ice bucket. He poured it all over her as he pulled her roughly through the section before tossing her outside of the velvet ropes. Throw her ass out, he told his two goons, who secured his section, making sure only those he invited entered his space. He had caused a scene. Shayna was laughed out of the club as she shouted, Fuck you, Messiah! You good, G? Messiah looked at his best friend. I guess his name is Issa. Okay, the name is Issa. Not like Issa Rae with two S's, just one. I'm solid. This just in here talking reckless. Pour up, Messiah said. In all the years I've known you, nigga, you're never down to drink around a crowd. What happened to all that holistic shit that nigga Ethic be putting in your head? Sober body, sober mind, and shit, Issa said. Messiah reached for another bottle of champagne and tilted it toward his mouth. It's needed tonight. Trust. The way I feel, I might blow a nigga head off. She's just having fun, bruh. She's playing with these niggas in here. She knows she got it. These thirsty motherfuckers in here are puppets on her string, Issa said. He had never known Messiah to invest his energy into any woman, let alone one as young as Morgan, but the jealousy that danced in Messiah's eyes were a dead giveaway to things he wouldn't dare say. Messiah wanted to deny what Issa was insinuating, but he wasn't the type to spread falsehoods, so he opted to take another gulp of the liquor instead. The mood lighting in the club made the way Morgan was moving her body even more sensual, and Messiah's chest was tight as her dancing partner's hands roamed her. His section wasn't short of groupies. There were always women hanging around, willing to do whatever to be chosen for the night. Messiah usually didn't fall for the trap, but he needed leverage, or at the very least, someone to take his mind off Morgan. She was the forbidden fruit. Not only was she young, she was Ethic's pride and joy. Getting involved with her would be teetering on disrespect, and Messiah knew how Ethic handled impertinence. Messiah feared no one, but he wasn't looking to offend a living legend either. He valued the guidance Ethic so graciously offered. He turned his back to the dance floor, opting to appreciate the random beauty that was vying hard for his attention. And there's a little break in the chapter. Listen, honey. Miss Buck said, I get up and move around with my earbud or just grab the replay. Yeah, well, see, I can't do that because I'm stuck in one spot reading to y'all unless I go pop. So Kay said, question. I was kind of confused. I thought they stayed in Kansas City, Missouri. Did they move back to Flint? Yes. When at the, I'm guessing, at some point between Raven dying and Morgan aging, he moved back to Flint, Michigan. So, but he seems to have gotten out of the game, based on what they're saying. So he's just taken his money, that his profits that he made from, being in the game, and bought some legitimate businesses. And so now he's schooling this young cat, Messiah. So he may still have his big toe in the game, but I don't think he's completely in it. And I'm guessing he brought Dolce with him. Yeah. A mess. I don't like it though, because I don't like Dolce. I don't like her. She's trash. All right, back to the story. Morgan was the life of the party. The ecstasy in her system made her feel like she was flying. She was loose, wild, and the free feeling she had chased most of her life was finally hers. She appreciated it, even if it was only temporary. Her hurt feelings were replaced with confidence and a sensuality that she had never felt before. Why trip over the interest of one man when she had the eyes of many? As Morgan danced off beat, she felt him watching. She wanted him to see how many men wanted her, how she could have her pick of them. How dare he bring someone else to my party and act like I'm invisible, like I'm a kid, I'm a grown woman, and he won't notice it until someone else has, she thought. A sheer sheen of sweat covered her body, causing the thin fabric of her short dress to cling to her. Her taut nipples were visible through the dress. She was on fire, and she liked it. From the feeling of the guy behind her, she could tell he did too. And from the look on Messiah's face, she had accomplished her mission. Damn, you just out here fucking shit up, huh? Nish yelled over the loud music. The song ended, and Nish handed Morgan another drink. Last call. Morgan took the glass and tossed the shot back, frowning as she felt a shot of liquor burn her throat all the way down. You and your homegirl want to grab food afterwards? The guy hugged her from behind, whispering the words into the crevice of her neck, not knowing that Morgan couldn't hear him. She eased out of his grip to walk away, but he pulled her back. She turned to see his lips. You leaving with me? He asked. He wanted the trophy. She could see it in his eyes. He wanted to be the one to take Benjamin Atkins's daughter home. She knew what that felt like, to want to win the prize. She had competed for her father's affection when her sister Raven was alive. When she was little, she competed for affection with Ethic because biologically she wasn't his, and he couldn't possibly love her as much as he did his own children, no matter how much he assured her otherwise, right? Tonight, she competed against every other woman in the club that wanted the upcoming king of the city, Messiah. She competed for him, and still, he acted as though she didn't exist. She glanced in Messiah's direction, noticing that he was headed for the door with a girl flanking, stumbling, not too far behind. Her envy made her agree. He was leaving with someone, so she would too. She was the master at tit for tat. She nodded as the guy grabbed her hand and led her out the club. The parking lot was the after party and the real reason why people showed up to the hole in the wall at all. Inside the club, it was too dark to truly size up the opposition. Under the shining streetlights was where the real from the fake was discerned. Diamonds and rims, foreigns and Chevys, it was all on full display as partiers hung out on the hoods of cars, still pouring, still sipping, still enjoying the high of the night. This was Flint. This was the life. A Saturday night on the strip of Clio Road. She was headed to the car of a big fish, Lucas. He wasn't as major as Messiah, but he was getting money and was a respectable catch. While she was jealous of the girl on Messiah's arm, there were plenty of women envying her as she climbed into the passenger side of Lucas's black Cadillac Escalade. I done told you about them goddamn Escalades, especially the black ones. Y'all listen. Messiah got on his Kawasaki Ninja. The Yves Saint Laurent motorcycle jacket he wore made him look like he was a model instead of an actual rider. He handed the girl he was with a helmet as he pushed his own down over his head. Issa mounted the bike next to Messiah's as the rest of their crew prepared to ride behind them. They weren't a gang, but it was rare that you caught Messiah without his shooters. Are you not gonna put a stop to that? Issa asked as he nodded towards the Escalade. She choosing. Ain't my business, Messiah said arrogantly as he revved his engine loudly while the random girl wrapped her arms around his waist. He sped out of the parking lot, starting a chain reaction as Issa and the rest of their team whipped out behind him. The fun ended for Morgan when she saw Messiah leave. Suddenly, her interest in leaving with Lucas waned. Messiah had brought her down. Suddenly, she felt the urge to go home and cry face down in a pillow. Child, sometimes that ain't a bad thing, but he was always around, always moving and shaking in the same places she liked to frequent. It was torture being around what she knew she couldn't have. Now that he was no longer paying attention, she wished she had gone home instead. She turned to the back seat where Niche was cozied up with one of Lucas's friends. Morgan was too young to know the power of the feeling that was filling her gut. It was instinct telling her to get out of the car, but she was already fighting so many misconceptions. She was just trying to be down. She knew if she messed up the flow of the night, they would think she was lame or childish. They pulled out of the parking lot, and despite her nagging gut ringing an alarm, she went anyway. This pressure she felt in her chest that made it hard to breathe, hard to swallow. It told her she was different from everyone around her, and she just wanted to be the same. So she stayed silent as Lucas placed a hand on her thigh, inching his fingers up toward the place between her legs as they drove. She tensed, and he slipped her a pill. "You need to relax," he said. She knew it was ecstasy. She wasn't a stranger to the euphoric feeling it provided. And if she was going to go through with this, she would need help. She knew Lucas's expectation of her, and it was too late to say no. She took the pill, grabbing the bottle of vodka that was being passed around the car to rinse it down with. It only took minutes to take effect, and she felt the indecision leaving her as they pulled into a motel. What the hell? Come on, man. All right. So this is how it's gonna be, eh? Okay, I thought we were getting food, she signed as she turned to face Niche. Relax, we can order something, Niche signed back. Y'all talking shit about us right in our face, huh? Lucas asked with a smile. Nah, just a little girl talk, Niche answered. Relax, these niggas are a big deal, bitch, she signed. Morgan and Niche weren't impressed by the same things. Niche was chasing material things that could be bought and sold, which in turn meant she was up for sale, willing to rent her body out to the highest bidder. Morgan was chasing a feeling of unconditional love, acceptance, appreciation for her uniqueness. She knew before she stepped across the threshold of the seedy motel room that Lucas couldn't give her that, but she wasn't looking to spoil everyone's fun. Morgan got out of the truck and followed everyone inside. The stale scent of tobacco filled the dated room. Morgan poured herself another shot, taking it to the head, the burn giving her confidence as Lucas pulled her down onto his lap. "You're sexy as fuck," he growled as he leaned back on the bed, his elbows supporting him. She tried to pull back, but he pulled her down with him, her dress riding up, exposing her thong as Niche pulled out her phone. He was attractive, but he wasn't Messiah, and she wasn't feeling how hard he was going. "Chill," she signed. "Slow down." "What'd she say?" he asked as he looked at Niche. "She said she wants you to fuck her," Niche said belligerently as she stuck out her tongue and turned the camera toward herself so she could show out for her viewers on social media. "I'm live right now and my baby Mo about to get that cherry pop," she bragged. The guy she was with leaned into her video. "What about your cherry?" he asked. They were visibly high as he stuck his tongue down Niche's throat. "You gotta pay to play over here," Niche responded. "You ain't said nothing," the guy responded as he flashed a money roll for the camera. "This nigga about to hit that retarded pussy," the guy said. Pause. So her best friend really ain't shit, y'all. Because that's not what she said. Okay. Here we go. This is why you got to know who you hang with, because a bitch will set your ass up real quick. Damn. This is it. See what I'm saying, Kay? This is that bullshit. This is what y'all don't understand why I be saying some of these black women out here, and it starts in their youth, ain't shit. They were ain't shit girls. They were ain't shit teenagers, ain't shit young women, and they grow into ain't shit mammies, mules, and battle axes. Just, oh. Anyway. That shit looked fat from the back, though. He took Nisha's phone and turned it back to Morgan as Nisha laughed at the joke. Morgan pulled away. "Stop. It's not happening tonight," she signed as she climbed off him, pulling down the thin fabric that barely covered her behind. She turned to Nisha and noticed her laughing. "This nigga too thirsty," Morgan signed. "You ready to go?" Morgan frowned as she pushed Nisha's phone out of her face. "Nisha, relax, baby," Lucas said as she sat up and pulled. I think she meant as he sat up and pulled her back onto the bed. You scared of the dick? Morgan pushed him hard this time and headed for the door. She snatched it open, but the weight of his body behind her forced it closed. It was times like these when her voice was needed, when she had to be able to say stop or no. Nisha's look of amusement told her that they weren't taking her seriously. She just wanted to leave. She wanted to get out of this room and away from this man. She grimaced as he pressed his erection into her. She felt dirty as her face pressed against the wood door. She struggled against him, but he was too heavy and too burly. She wasn't getting loose until he let her. She could feel his lips on the back of her neck. They were moving, but she couldn't make out what he was saying. I don't want this, she thought, as tears of disbelief clouded her vision. I'm about to get mad, y'all. His tongue felt like a snake on her skin, and his calloused hands pulled her thong to the side. Her body went limp when he broke into her. This was a burglary. He was taking her, and she couldn't help but think she was partly to blame. She felt him break her hymen, and tears came to her eyes as she struggled against the weight of him. She had started this with the seduction in the club, the dancing, all to make Messiah jealous. She had ignited a fire she couldn't put out, fake interest when there was none. And she had ignored that feeling, that alarm that had told her to get out of his fucking truck. Her mind screamed, no, she had never done this before, and there was no delicate approach. This was an attack he rammed inside of her. And when she closed her eyes, she felt tears wet her cheeks. He was ripping her in half, proving a point that he was defiling Benny Atkins's daughter. Please stop. Please just let it be over, she thought. The fact that he wasn't wearing a condom made her skin crawl. There was nothing she could do but take it. And when he was done, she crumpled onto the floor. Morgan, Nish called, her laughter waning when she finally realized that Morgan was crying. Lucas waved her off. She'll be all right. Come here. You up next. Bruh, go get in that. Shit is amazing, Lucas bragged. Nish cut off the camera and looked back at Morgan. She was visibly shaken. The decision to be uncool and check on her friend was overridden by her desire to be down. Nish wasn't like Morgan. She didn't come from a family that was well known. She had to suck and fuck her way to the top, just like every other little ghetto girl in the city. That was her mentality. Sad as it may be, good sex was all she was known for. She was okay with that. If she put it on Lucas and his homeboy the right way, she knew they would throw her a few dollars. And if they bragged on how good she was, every baller in the city would come sniffing for a taste. It wasn't hooking. It was just the game. Morgan had never had to play it. That's why she was devastated. What does she think would happen? You don't come to the motel at 2 in the morning unless you're trying to fuck, Nish thought. I told you she's good. Now come here, Lucas said, roughly pulling Nish onto his hardness as he licked his lips. He was rolling on the E-pills he had taken. It had him ravenous, and Nish was desperately trying to be chosen. You got something stronger than weed? I'm rolling, but my high coming down, she said. I get nasty when I feel good, Nish teased. You get nasty, huh? Lucas questioned, intrigued. Walk with me to the car. I got a little something. Morgan reached for Nish as they passed her, but Nish shook her off. Nish felt in front of, wait, no, Nish knelt in front of Morgan. Relax. My turn. Have a drink. Have some fun for once, Nish said. I'll be back. Homie will entertain you. Morgan struggled to her feet. Her legs felt like they would give out at any moment. Devastation and anger flooded her. She could see the lust in this random guy's eyes as he approached her. Was this rape? Was she giving off vibes that this was okay? She didn't want this. This wasn't how her night was supposed to turn out. Morgan didn't know what she had done to invite this violation. Was dancing in a club and barely their clothing the signs that had given these men the green light to have their way with her? If that were the case, she wouldn't dare do it again. The attention, the spotlight, feeling sexy, chasing maturity, none of it was worth the humiliation she felt now. Suddenly, she just wanted to go home. She wanted to be the girl complaining from her locked room. She yearned for ethics over protectiveness. If she had listened to him, she would have never been in this situation. A million regrets ran through her mind as she was swarmed with confusion. Her head was spinning, she was nauseous, and the fear that she would have to endure another body inside her made the contents of her stomach come flying out. Damn, bitch, you throwing up on my shoes and shit, the guy said. He pushed her hard to the floor, disgusted, as he stepped around her vomit. She scrambled for the door as she pulled down on her dress, wishing it had a little more fabric to cover her ass. She had never felt more exposed than she did now. The wetness between her legs disgusted her. Remnants of Lucas was leaking out of her, and it wasn't until that moment she realized he hadn't even used a condom. Where you going, huh? He asked as he pulled her by her hair so roughly that she felt him ripping the braids from her scalp. She grimaced as he flung her on the bed. Turn around, he growled as he flipped her roughly. Morgan tried to crawl to the other side of the bed, but the guy caught an ankle and pulled her toward him, spreading her legs wide as he put his weight on her back, pinning her. She had never been so scared. The room spun as she clawed at the dirty sheets beneath her. She needed to brace herself. She felt him hanging between her legs. She went crazy, flopping her body wildly to try to stop him from entering her. The guy put a forearm to the back of her neck, stuffed her face into the mattress. Her lungs screamed for air. The more she fought, the harder he pushed. She couldn't breathe. She tried to sip the air, whatever relief she could find, but he had her head pressed so firmly that she knew he had no problem killing her. Stop fighting, bitch. He grew frustrated by her lack of cooperation and was too caught up in his assault to realize she couldn't hear his command. He punched her in the back of the head, and Morgan saw flashes of white as her head rang from the blow. She stopped moving, stopped resisting, because if she didn't, she knew she wouldn't make it out of the room. His weight eased slightly, and she was able to gulp in air. She screamed in agony as he rammed himself into her. It was different than what Lucas had done. This man was taking her anally and without any lubrication. She howled. The pain was so great that she couldn't stand it, but she had no choice but to endure it. She was grateful when she felt him pull out and empty his seeds on her back. Retarded bitch, he stated, as he hawked up a glob of spit and marred her body with more of his fluids before buckling his pants and fleeing from the room. I'm just fucking disgusted. What the fuck y'all got me reading up here? Who suggested this book? I need somebody's ass to kick. Who suggested this book? Somebody better tell me who suggested it, because I can't remember. But oh boy, when I do, I'm gonna beat your ass. Oh my God. She rushed into the bathroom and closed the door, locking it behind her. She had lost control and she covered her mouth to stifle her cries as she sobbed uncontrollably. She was too afraid to step out into the room. She desperately hoped Niche came back for her. How could she just watch? Morgan thought. She didn't know if they were coming back for more, but she would barricade herself in the bathroom until housekeeping came in the morning. And there's a break in the chapter. Oh, all right. Open your door. I'm coming to kick your ass. If you at work, send me a DM on Instagram to the address to your job, because I'm going to be waiting for your ass in the parking lot, ma'am. Oh, my God. This is crazy. Hold on, y'all. Hold on 1 second, y'all. I'm chasing a fly. This ain't gonna work. I don't know how he got in here. Hold on. Ah, sorry, y'all. Whoops. Tearing shit up. Yeah. I got his ass. I don't know how he got in here. But I'm telling you, when you go in and out, leave that right here. Because when you go in, it's hot outside, it's Texas, and they just be every fucking way. Child, you can run outside for a quick second and they just damn. Ugh. All right. Marvin said it's good, keep going. And Nordic said, I'm at work. I'll be in the parking lot when you get off, ma'am. I'll be right outside. Thank y'all for your patience. All right. Y'all know how I feel about bugs. Flies, gnats, and bees. They all the same to me. I don't fool around. You can't stay in here. No God. All right. Yo, bruh, you might want to look at this, Issa said as he slid his iPhone across the table. Ah, that's because of the video that Morgan, not Morgan, Niche took. And I hope she stayed the fuck away from that girl, but something tell me she probably won't. I don't know. Young girls are so slow. They slow boppers for Christ. Oh, have mercy. Messiah took his arm from around the young lady he was entertaining and frowned as he picked it up. When his eyes landed on the video on the screen, fire coursed through his veins. This lie? He asked, his jaw clenching in anger. Yeah, man, Issa said. That little bitch Niche screaming that shit on IG. Messiah's heart settled in his stomach as he watched Morgan fight against Lucas in the video. It was obvious that she wasn't a willing participant. Even if she was, Messiah would have reacted the same. He heard Niche and another voice making insulting jokes as they witnessed Morgan struggle, but did nothing to help. Social media revealed all, and he took note of the location before he stood to his feet. I'm right behind you, Issa said, already aware that they were about to get into some gunplay. I got it, Messiah shouted over his shoulder. He pushed open the door to the diner with so much force that he cracked it. He hopped on his bike, feeling nothing but pure rage before speeding off. He was across town in less than 10 minutes. Messiah didn't know how he had gotten so emotionally invested in Morgan, but he hadn't been able to take his mind off her since the night at the falls. Most girls oversold themselves. They made promises and talked too much, but Morgan just existed. He felt everything she thought she couldn't convey just by the way she looked at him. It was like she pleaded with him to hear her, and he did. He just couldn't reciprocate. It wouldn't be right. The two of them didn't make sense, but to see someone hurt her and put it out for the world to see had him in the mood for murder. Messiah was best avoided when he was in this state of mind. Men had lost their lives for less. He wanted to be angry at Morgan for putting herself in such a precarious position, but all he could think about was getting to her. What she had endured was punishment enough. The embarrassment, the violation, he knew she would have to walk around their small city with even more judgment than she had on her before. Walking in her shoes couldn't be easy. He knew it. He walked into the office. Lucas Hill's room. I need the key and I need the number, Messiah said as he placed a small knot of $100 bills wrapped in a rubber band on the countertop. Flint was a city where everybody knew everybody. He and Lucas had been longtime rivals for years. Messiah was always one step ahead of Lucas, and it had resulted in jealousy that had compounded like interest on a loan. I should have snatched her out the club when I saw her dancing on this nigga, Messiah thought, feeling as though he was part to blame in the way the night had turned out. Nah, mm-mm. No, sir. Mm-mm. This is on her. This is on her. The old white woman at the desk pulled out her Newport, expertly balancing the long ash that had burned out on the end. She blew the smoke toward the ceiling as she slid the money into her pocket. She didn't say a word as she slid him a key card and held up seven fingers. Messiah rushed out, heading toward the door. He drew his pistol and then slid the key into the door. The room was empty. The only sign that anyone had been there at all was the crumpled sheets and empty liquor bottles that were left behind. Fuck, he whispered. He pulled out his phone and shot a text to Morgan. Where are you? The buzzing sound drew his attention toward the purse that was tossed on the floor. Soft whimpers could be heard through the bathroom door, and he rushed to open it. Morgan, open the door. It's Messiah, he said. Authority and worry laced his tone. It took him a second to register that she couldn't hear him. He stepped back in frustration and lifted a wheat-colored Timberland boot as he kicked the door, springing it open. The look of terror on her tear-stained face as she looked up at him, tore through him. When she realized who he was, she rushed into his arms, crying hysterically. Messiah bit into the side of his jaw as his teeth clenched, and he held onto her tightly. Every tear she shed was like tiny rocks dinging his chest, trying to break through the wall, trying to expose how much he cared. He held her firmly as he let his body sink to the dirty floor. The murderous thoughts that ran through his mind caused his chest to heave up and down as he rocked her back and forth. "Shh, it's okay," he whispered. "I got you." He told himself that he was there because Morgan was like a sister, like family. But what he was feeling was more than that. It was territorial, as if Lucas should have known better than to lay hands on someone he coveted so dearly. They sat there like that for over an hour until she had cried it all out. She stood to her feet, wiping her nose with the back of her hand. He stood as well. He stared at her, his concern apparent. "Let me take you home," he said. "I can't go home," she signed. He got the gist of it. Her disheveled appearance, her puffy eyes, it would be a dead giveaway that something had gone horribly wrong. "I'll take you somewhere," he said. She nodded and gathered her purse before he grabbed her hand and led her outside. Morgan rested her face on his back as she climbed on the back of his bike. He could still feel her shaking as she wrapped her arms around his waist. He shook his head as he kicked off the stand and revved the engine before taking off into the night. Morgan closed her eyes as the cool wind chilled her, and she hugged him even tighter. He was an instant remedy for her affliction. She secretly wondered if she had caused all this just to get this type of attention from Messiah. Her tears were silent, unforced. They just kept coming, sliding down her face, wetting the back of his leather jacket, causing her skin to stick to it slightly. Everything flew by them in a blur. The speed and the water in her eyes made this feel like a bad dream. She just wanted to start the day over and erase the stupid decision she had made that had led to such a disastrous night. Morgan placed her hands under his jacket so that her skin was touching his. Her hands laid flat on his chest. The beat of his heart was so intense that she breathed to its rhythm, and it soothed her. She hugged him tighter. God, why couldn't this man be hers? Why couldn't he see past his relationship with Ethic, past her age, past her hearing, past this night? He would never admit it, but she was sure her differences scared him. She wanted to be mad at him for that, but she had dealt with it her entire life, people judging her, thinking she was stupid or lacking because she couldn't hear. It was frustrating, especially so with Messiah, because she had never wanted something so badly. He steered the bike with one hand as he placed a hand over hers reassuringly. He intertwined his fingers with hers, making a joint fist over his heart, and Morgan sucked in a bated breath. Such a simple gesture made her turn to mush inside. He cares. He can't do stuff like that and not care, she thought. Just as quickly as he did it, he took his hand away, refocusing on the powerful machine they rode. Messiah was selfish with his love in that way, only giving her crumbs and made her want to taste it all. He was holding back, and trying to bait him into jealousy had ended dangerously for her. On the back of his bike, she felt safe. She felt owned, as if she was an object to possess, as if she was his most prized and wished it could stay that way. "Listen, I need her to get to a Walgreens and get a after, what is it, a after seven? After seven, that's a whole fucking group. After morning, what is the fucking pill called? The next day pill or whatever. It's something with after in it. After. What is the name of the fucking pill?" Child, listen. I just said after morning, after seven, after morning, after hours. Plan B. There you go. Thank you, Kay. Thank you. When they pulled into the driveway of a large home, she frowned. This wasn't the house he had taken her to before. It was beautiful, a large family home with a manicured lawn made completely of brick. He cut the engine and they climbed off, removing their helmets. She motioned toward the house with an inquisitive look. "This is my crib. Nobody knows about this place. I don't bring anybody here, ever. That's the only way I get to sleep with both eyes closed," she said. Morgan smiled slightly because he trusted her. "You can stay here for the night and get yourself together. Text Ethic and let them know you're staying with one of your homegirls tonight," Messiah said. She did as she was told as she followed Messiah inside. The house was beautiful, modern, and new. It barely looked lived in at all. "There's a guest bedroom upstairs. There are fresh tiles in the bathroom," he said. "I'll be back." He turned to leave, but Morgan grabbed his hand, turning him back toward her. She shook her head. "Stay," she mouthed the words as she signed. "Please stay. Morgan could see the blaze in his eyes. She knew where he was headed. She was aware of his reputation, and though she was flattered that he would react on her behalf, she just wanted him there with her. Messiah exhaled, as if it pained him to oblige her. He was the type of nigger who scratched an itch immediately. If he let it linger, it would drive him crazy. He had never learned to tether his aggression. His temper was so hot that once it was ignited, nothing would stop him from exploding. He had a vengeful spirit. Disrespect begot disrespect. He lived by a code that was so G, it was hard for others to keep up. And when they slipped, he punished them. He had been waiting for an excuse to lay Lucas down for years anyway. This beef had been cooking for a long time. Morgan was just the needle that broke the hustler's back. He was as cold-blooded as they came, but for some reason, the sight of Morgan in front of him, trembling as large droplets of emotion clung to her long eyelashes, moved him. "Don't worry, I'm not going anywhere," he said. "Come on." He led her to the bathroom where he turned on the shower. "Everything you need is under the sink," he offered. He pointed, and she nodded. When she turned, he noticed blood on the back of her dress. It was like gasoline to his fury. He dug his phone out of his jacket pocket. "Meet me in an hour and a half. You know where." He sent the text to Issa, but he was sure his man was already anticipating the play. There was no way Messiah wasn't going to see Lucas tonight. He would make sure Morgan was straight, but as soon as she closed her eyes, he had every intention of committing murder tonight. He gave her privacy and left the room, going into his master bedroom to retrieve something she could sleep in. He didn't entertain women in his home. He didn't trust anyone enough to reveal where he closed his eyes. "A bitch'll get you murked even quicker than these lame-ass niggas nowadays," he thought. "Absolutely, 'cause child, when they get mad, the first thing they gonna tell somebody is where you lay your head." Right. Always bringing drama. Anyway. Oh, he rifled through his clothes, knowing that there was nothing feminine to find. A t-shirt and hoop shorts will have to do. He went back to the bathroom, but halted as the sound of muffled cries infiltrated the hallway. He felt intrusive, as if he was bearing witness to a moment that wasn't meant for him to see. Messiah didn't know what to do with emotions. It had never been his job to cater to the feelings of another person. He had never wanted the responsibility, because in his mind, he knew he would be no good at it. Defending her honor, he could do, but restoring it felt like a challenge that was meant for a father. She had none. Ethic tried to play the role, but Messiah knew Morgan resisted it every step of the way. He balled his hand, using the knuckle of one finger to rap softly on the door, again out of habit because she couldn't hear him. That was the problem. He didn't know how to be with her. It was so easy to forget that she was deaf. He pushed the door open slightly and peeked his head in coyly, not wanting to pry. He hoped she was decent. He only wanted to help her. And if he was honest, he desperately wanted her to stop crying because hearing her was chipping away at something inside his chest. He hurt with her, as if they shared a connection where one felt the other's torment. It was odd, at least to a man who extended his time and effort at a minimum. This feeling was new. Her cries stopped suddenly as their eyes met, as if she had been caught being hurt, exposed, being human. She sat on the side of the toilet, the bloody dress still on her. He stepped inside and leaned against the door. He wished he had a mother or sister who could help him deal with this girl. Morgan, with her vulnerability and her beauty, was knocking at the door inside him that he kept locked. She was asking him to love her without saying anything at all, and Messiah didn't want to, but surely this ache he had on the left side of his chest, behind all the brawn and muscle, was love. He crossed the room and got on his knees in front of her as he began to remove her clothes. He started with her jewelry. The diamonds on her neck and wrists were brilliant, just another accessory that exasperated the girls around the city that were, simply, not on Morgan's level. She was another breed, a dying class, a vintage version of a model of hustlers' wives that no longer existed. She just didn't know it. She was Justine Atkins's daughter. Her beauty was inherited. If only Morgan knew her worth. Her last name was the reason why Messiah hesitated. Her history was the reason why he respected her. Kendrick had described it best. It was loyalty and royalty inside her DNA. I love that song. I got royalty, or it's royalty and loyalty inside my DNA. I love that song by Kendrick Lamar. He a weird looking dude too, but anyway. Messiah was undressing a queen, and because of this, he did it respectfully, hoping that she would be able to get herself together enough to finish the job before her beautiful body was exposed. She sat there, however, soft tears falling, head bowed disgracefully as she wrung her fingers nervously. Messiah started with her dress next, rolling it up her smooth skin and pulling it gently over her head as she raised her arms. Her panties were gone, and she wore no bra. Messiah reached around her, running warm water into the spa-sized bath, and she turned to submerge inside the tub. He washed her gently, slowly, his strong hands rubbing the knots of tension out of her shoulders as he cleaned her from head to toe. It felt like a privilege, as if he was washing the dirt off the toes of a queen because she was truly too special to walk through the grudge of the earth. Morgan was like a goddess, and he was simply mortal. She wasn't supposed to be susceptible to the tangible ills of the streets. She was above them. If she realized that, she wouldn't pursue it, but he knew she was just trying to find a place where she belonged. She was displaced, the only one left standing in her family name, and she was searching for something. She was attracted by the allure of the game. He had to stop her from self-destructing, even if only for tonight. He tried to wash away her tears, his wet finger wiping them, but they were only replaced with new ones. He turned her chin to him and she looked at him, her bottom lip quivering. "I'm sorry. Nobody's gonna disrespect you again, I promise. That's my word," he said. "Come on, we're done." He let out the water and held open a towel as she stepped out of the tub. Her body glistened. It was the work of art he had always suspected existed beneath her clothes. He felt like not even he should have had the privilege to see it. It only angered him more about the events that had landed her at his house tonight. She tied the towel securely around her body and followed him into the master bedroom. He dressed her and then sat beside her on the edge of his bed. There were so many things he wanted to say to her, but they had an entire language between them. "You're gonna have to teach me some signs. There are things I can't say because I don't know how. Things I don't understand. I want to be able to. It's important," he said as she stared at him. Morgan nodded, her heart aching for this moment, but realizing it was ruined by everything that had occurred. "I can teach you," she signed. He pulled his phone out of his jacket pocket and handed it to her, opening the notes. She typed in the words instead. He nodded, not liking the bruised feeling that existed inside his chest. It was like he had been hit, and the tenderness that an injury left behind was inside him, consuming him. It was like she held the key that unlocked the cage surrounding his heart. She was digging past all the muscle, past his ribs, past all the walls he had formed over the years, determined to touch him on the inside. He didn't like the feeling. Unfamiliar with the way infatuation left a man weak, he only knew that Morgan being around him was a potential problem. He had his choice with the women in the city, and no one made him feel as touchable as this young girl. Morgan affected him, despite his efforts to keep her in the off-limits zone. He stood to his feet. "I have to go," he said. There was no more delaying the inevitable, and concern flickered in Morgan's eyes. "I have to," he repeated before she could protest. She knew there was no stopping it. Her recklessness had set a chain of events in motion that no one would be able to prevent. "I'll be back. Try and rest," he said. She watched him walk away, his stride filled with rage and determination. She was flattered. Wars had been sparked over less, but Morgan didn't want Messiah shedding blood on her behalf. She had already lost too much. She couldn't stand the idea of losing him before she even got the chance to know him fully, to love him, to have him as her own. Unsure of what to do, but knowing that nothing was not an option, she rushed to her phone. Ethic was the only person who could stop Messiah from doing something stupid. Morgan knew that she would be exposing her lies by asking Ethic for help, but she would have to put herself aside to make sure Messiah was okay. And that's the end of that chapter. Well, that was a lot, y'all, in one chapter. Even with the little break to catch the fly, which I think another one that got in here, because every time you slide that patio door open, it's just they just be around like, "What you cooking in there? What you got going on?" Oh my God. They just don't know how to stay outside. They're supposed to be outside. All right. So, what are y'all thinking? Should we keep going with this shit? Because ain't nobody took this girl to get a fucking plan B yet. That's the thing he should have been telling Issa to go get. Did the plan B even exist when this book was written? Probably not. But she needed fucking squash squash or something. Like, oh my God, which one of them? Oh, the other guy went in. Yeah, so no chance of him. But Lucas could end up getting her pregnant. Child, listen, I can't stand them. Ugh, and mosquitoes too, because it's a bunch of trees on the side. It's just right, let me get this time stamp, child, for the next chapter, because Lord have mercy. I think some people come to my channel expecting for me to just straight read the book. And I say it in the description box, but people don't read, child. You're gonna hear all kinds of shit happening over here. Sipping coffee, sipping water, laughing, all types of shit. It's apps for you that want an AI book to read to you. I mean, an AI person to read to you. This ain't that. Gone somewhere now. I don't do that over here. Okay. Let's get ready for this next chapter, child. Chapter 4. Ethic hated when the streets baited him. Losing control and allowing the game to lure him back was a weakness. As he drove through the city, pushing the horses under the hood of his foreign car to the max, he knew that the devil inside him had been awakened. There were just certain people in his life that were off limits. Child, I don't know. I don't know. We don't know. It's unclear. I know he's it said anally, but I don't know, Marva. You know, I mean, because he still could have, you know, there's ways to rupture the thin membrane between both and, you know, end up spilling it the other way. But child, this is insane. All right, Morgan was one of them. The fact that someone had hurt her had him in a blind fury and he couldn't get to his destination fast enough. He appreciated Messiah's effort, but Ethic would put in this work himself. He battled between his humanity and his ruthlessness daily, trying his hardest to keep himself from reigning over the city with an iron fist. He had learned the art of humility, had developed an appreciation for the simple life, but he had never lost touch with the streets. He had been raised in them, rooted in them, and a man always knew how to tap into the roots of his soul. Ethic was a gangster, and not in the corny way that men claim to be. He was effortlessly deadly, callously calculating, and unforgivingly deceptive. He played the good guy well because he desperately wanted to be a man of character, a man that his children could be proud of, and a man that a woman could love. But he had to. He tapped into, oh, but when he had to. He tapped into the darkest parts of him. She used the wrong tense of two. She used 200 instead of, you know, TO. But anyway. Only when he must, often when he was pushed, always for the ones he loved. He was the king of the city, and because he had been on a soul-searching journey, his discreetness had been mistaken for weakness. He was about to light the entire fucking city up. Lucas had trespassed, and the thought of the young hustler violating Morgan was enough to make him move without apology. It was enough to make him call Lily in for overtime to watch Bella and Easy while he handled the disrespect. Lucas was a young hustler around the city. He was 25 and raking in a lot of cash on the city's south side. He was flashy, loud, a real-life character who was used to having his way. Where Messiah ran the north end of the city, Lucas was his adversary across town. Bad blood existed between them, often over turf, often over women. The two men just differed on principle alone, but Ethic had kept Messiah on a leash each time Lucas tried to bait Messiah into beef. War is bad for business, Ethic had said. Now he wished that he had given Messiah the green light to eliminate the threat. Well, it just would have been somebody else, that's all. I mean, come on now, Ethic. You act like bad men don't exist, sir. They do. And rape culture is real. It's not just in Flint, Michigan, sir. It's all around the world. It's the same song. Now, Lucas had crossed a line. There had to be consequences to that. Ethic hadn't felt this type of anger in years. The last time he had allowed himself to act with this much rage, it had ended tragically. His dear love, Raven, had lost her life. He had tried to control his ire by leaving the streets behind, but the worst parts of him were bubbling, threatening to surface. This was personal. Morgan was family to him, and knowing that she didn't possess the words to say no during Lucas's assault had his temperature rising simultaneously with his speedometer. He already knew where to find Lucas. The dumb hustler was so flamboyant that he wanted the entire hood to see him shine. He lived off Circle Drive, one of the old neighborhoods in Flint that reflected a time when the city was booming from the automotive industry. Lucas wasn't smart enough to stay low while he got rich. He was dumb enough to let niggas know where he rested his head. Now that Ethic was ready to behead him, he knew exactly where to go. That was the problem with young niggas these days. They didn't respect the rules. They moved incorrectly. Ethic pulled up on the darkened block and immediately knew that Messiah had arrived before him. Every street light had been broken out to avoid any neighbors witnessing the melee that the night would bring. Ethic's headlights illuminated through the back of an older model Chevy Tahoe. He knew it was stolen, and he knew Messiah and his goon lay in wait inside. He cut his lights and picked up his cell. Messiah answered on the first ring. Morgan called me. "Send your people home and come hop in the passenger seat," Ethic said. Messiah didn't protest. Ethic waited patiently as Messiah put the order down. Moments later, the old truck started and Messiah climbed out before it pulled away. Ethic's temple throbbed as Messiah got in. "You're moving flawed," Ethic said. "I respect the fact that you're moving at all, considering this isn't your beat." Messiah was more invested than Ethic could even imagine. He had no idea the murderous thoughts that were racing through Messiah's mind. "What I tell you, murder is something you do alone and only when completely necessary," Messiah interrupted, finishing his sentence. "No offense, OG, but it's necessary. You didn't see her," Messiah said, his tone flat and serious. "And Issa is my man. I trust him." "You don't know who you can trust. You can't trust anybody when it comes to murder. The same nigga that helped you put a body in a grave will be the same nigga pointing a finger at you in a court of law. Go home and make sure Morgan's good," Ethic said. Ethic knew Messiah had plenty of bodies on him. The tattooed tear on the outer corner of his eye was a misprint. Ethic was sure he had sent more than one to their makeup. He knew the burden that death put on a man's soul, however, and Ethic wouldn't allow Messiah to dive deeper in a pool of sin, not on his behalf. "No offense, big homie, but this ain't about you," Messiah said. Messiah had never feared anyone, not even Ethic, but he would be remiss if he didn't admit that it took every ounce of courage in him to admit that he was acting on Morgan's behalf. A man only went that far for a woman he had stake in. The flicker of recognition shone in Ethic's eyes. Now wasn't the time to address Messiah's vague admission. A man takes care of his woman. If this is about a woman, then a man would be at her side. If it's about you, then we can walk in there and handle it together and burn something. The type of man that I would want my daughter with, and trust me, Morgan is like a daughter to me. That man would walk away and make sure she's good. A real man never puts himself in a position to leave his woman. Murder is 25 years to life. Is this some street shit between you and him? Or some kind of show of love for a woman? Because if it's for love, you got it backwards. Love keeps you at her side, healing wounds. This shit here is all motivated by hate. This shit here removes you from a woman's life faster than the blink of an eye. One minute, you're here defending her honor, catching a body. The next, you're trapped behind steel bars, watching her search for even half of you and the next nigga in line, Ethic said. His tone was scolding, and Messiah could hear the anger in his voice. He weighed the words on his soul. He desperately wanted to be the one to end Lucas, but he knew that Ethic was judging him in this moment. How Messiah moved would determine if Ethic would approve or disapprove of his feelings for Morgan. It would reveal whether Messiah was the type of man a father would allow to date his princess, despite blood relation. Messiah blew out a sharp breath, and without saying another word, he pulled open the door, flipped the hood to his sweatshirt up, and headed in the opposite direction of Lucas's house. Ethic nodded, slightly proud that Messiah had the self-control to walk away, but more than a little irritated that the young gunner had his sights on Morgan. It was a conversation for a different day, but one that would be had. Pause. I would think that if you wanted her to be with anybody, you would want her to be with somebody that you fucking trusted. And you appear to trust this nigga. So what is the problem, Epic? Or are you just so afraid of loss that you just like, I don't trust nobody? I don't know. I don't know. Yeah. That's my song, Marva. All right. Ethic eyed the house. The glow from a television shone through the broken blinds in the front window. It was the only light coming from inside. He reached toward his touch screen and pressed a special sequence of buttons, causing the screen to lift and reveal the hidden compartment behind it. He pulled out the pair of leather gloves that lay inside and placed them over his hands. The ski mask was next. He rolled it around his head so that when the time was right, he could pull it down over his face with ease. He then retrieved the dirty pistol that rested inside. Without serial numbers, it was untraceable. He screwed on the silencer and then parked at the corner before exiting and walking casually up the block. It was a quiet neighborhood, but he was still cautious, holding his head low. Ethic had an entire city of young wolves, including Messiah, that could have handled this for him, but he tried his hardest not to glorify what must be done. There was no glory in murder. There was no honor in it. It blackened his soul and came back to haunt his life so drastically that the only woman who loved him was a bitch named Karma. He didn't want Messiah to do as he had done. He wanted Messiah and the other young men he saw every day, the ones who saluted him, the ones who respected him, the ones who saw him as a street legend, to do the opposite of what he had done. He wanted them to tap into their royal blood and excel, to take over the city with their minds instead of diluting their worth by playing up to the stereotypes that had been placed on them. Black boys were more than hustlers, ball players, and rappers. He had fallen into that brainwash trap, and sure, it had made him rich, but at the same time, it had made him poor. His morality and mentality had been for sale, just like his ancestors that had been shackled before him. The only difference was Ethic had put the mental chains on himself. He was grateful he had avoided the physical ones, the bars, the steel, the confinement that this game ultimately led to. Nah, Ethic wouldn't contribute to the cycle by having broken boys follow his path in the streets. He would put in his own work and pray for Messiah and the young niggas behind him to find a better way. At least they wouldn't get lost under his command. He went up the driveway and rounded the backyard. He pulled the ski mask down, concealing his identity, and then tried the back door. To his surprise, it was unlocked, and he used his shoulder to push it open slowly while gripping the gun in his hand tightly. Stupid, he thought, as he shook his head at Lucas's carelessness. He getting all this money and can't take the time to lock the door? That was the problem with these new niggas. They moved too quickly, too sloppily. They were too quick to do everything. Snitch, kill, steal. This mistake would prove costly. Ethic followed the glow through the kitchen and into the living room where Lucas lay on his side, a thick blanket covering his body and his back facing Ethic. It was almost too easy. Ethic pulled the trigger, firing a full clip into Lucas. The whispers of the silence are barely audible as blood started to spread throughout the holes in the blanket. Ethic walked over to Lucas and reached down to turn him on his back to deliver a final headshot for good measure. He reached for Lucas's shoulder and flipped him on his back, but pulled back in horror when he saw the little girl tucked in the grooves beneath Lucas. She was struggling for air to breathe as Ethic saw the two bullets that had penetrated her chest. Lucas had been sleeping with a little girl in his arms. She had been hidden by the cover when Ethic had fired. No, he whispered. No. He pushed Lucas out of the way, unaffected by his dead weight as it hit the floor. But the little girl lying there, bleeding out, splintered him. He knew he should be making his exit, but he couldn't leave her there, dying senselessly. Children were supposed to be off limits. I didn't see her, he thought. He scooped the little girl in his arms, but as he looked in her face, all he saw was Bella. At any moment, his past would come around full circle and affect any of his children. It was a sad truth. The last thing he wanted was for this child to pay for Lucas's debt. Lucas's death wasn't worth the collateral damage that had been done. Nothing was worth the life of someone so young. She's a baby, he thought, his heart shattering at the sight of what he had just done. That was the one thing about triggers. They couldn't be unpulled. Fuck, he shouted. His phone was in the car. He turned left and then right, searching for a house phone. The little girl choked as blood flooded her mouth. The fear in her eyes caused turmoil to erupt inside him. Ethic wasn't built for this. Not anymore. Life had matured him. His children had shown him a side of himself that he never knew he had. He was no longer the ruthless man who could walk away unaffected after something like this. This would stain his conscience until the day he died. Ethic placed her on the couch as he frantically dug through Lucas's pockets to find a cell phone. He had no remorse for the body on the floor, but this little girl losing her life by the second was torment to his soul. He finally found it and dialed 911, not caring that he was sacrificing himself to save this child. He kept envisioning his children in the crossfires of war bleeding out because of some mistake he had made, and it burned his eyes with emotion. This was it. This was the deed that would put him under the jail, and as the little girl died in front of him, he thought, I deserve it. This was the part of the game he didn't like. Innocent people got hurt. They were casualties of circumstance, and Ethic was to blame for this young life lost. The sound of someone entering behind him caused him to turn, gun pointed, and he aimed at an old woman who held nothing but fear in her eyes. Ethic froze, and so did she as they both waited for the other to make a move. They stared at one another, the seconds seeming like hours as they sized one another up. The old Ethic would have popped her, laying her down right where she stood, but enough blood had been shed. The night was already tragic enough. He didn't need the life of an old woman on his soul. You get out of here, the old woman spoke, finally mustering all her courage as she held up a black purse as if it could provide some sort of defense. What did you do? She screamed as she ran to the little girl on the ground, her fear taking a back seat to her concern. Ethic backpedaled out of the house, jumping the fence in the backyard to make it to the next block. Snatching off the ski mask, he walked briskly back around to his truck and pulled away into the night. And that's the end of that chapter. Yeah, y'all, it'd be like that. That's sad. That's truly sad. Wow. Oh, baby. But her daddy a dumbass and left the door open. And more importantly than that, not only was he a dumbass and left the door open, her daddy was a dumbass and assaulted a young girl. Yes, she is, right? Yeah, this is good. Ashley is good. I know, right? I'm glad he had a ski mask on too. Shit. All right, so let me get my next time stamp, y'all, because this is I don't know what to think. And I gotta make sure I get out of here so I can pack and be at Nordic's job when she get off, because she the one that suggested this damn book. I got to kick her ass when she get off work. I know she like, wait a minute, what? I thought we had squashed our beef. Nope. Chapter 5. The pit that filled Morgan's stomach was so vast that she felt like it would suck her inside out. Like a black hole, she felt something pulling at her. She was sick as she sat on the stairway that led to the second floor and watched the foyer, counting every second since Messiah had gone. Please let him be okay, she thought. She was full of remorse and wound so tightly that when she saw the lock turn on the front door, she jumped out of her skin. She was on her feet, running to the door, and as she came through it, or rather as he came through it, she wrapped her arms around him, hugging him as she cried. He could barely keep his balance as she clung to him like a second skin, cupping his face in her hands and kissing his lips repeatedly. Messiah wanted to push her away. He knew that he should resist her, but the smell of her, the desperation emanating off of her, it magnetized him to her. Fuck it, he thought. His lips parted as he kissed her. Hungrily, stumbling backwards, pinning her to the wall as she caressed his face and his tongue took over her mouth. This kiss was soul-stirring, partly because Messiah never put his mouth on any woman. He didn't kiss. He didn't want to connect to anyone so personally. He didn't even lay a woman on her back when they sexed. Women were faceless to him, especially the type that chased him. They all wanted one thing, money, and he wanted one thing, pussy. It was a transaction, and kisses weren't accepted. Until now. This ain't right, he whispered, as he clenched his eyes shut and rested his forehead against hers. She was so young, so inexperienced. She was an Atkins girl. Everything rushing through his mind told him he was out of bounds, but that weak feeling, that ache in his chest told him he was still gonna play. She ignored him as she thought, nothing has ever been this right. Messiah rubbed his goatee as he took a step back. How did I know he had a goatee? Because niggas named Messiah always got a fucking goatee. He probably dark-skinned, too. With heavy meat. Anyway. Oh, my God. That heavy meat is dangerous, child. Had you sitting back taking shit you ain't had no business and doing things you hadn't planned on, you heard me? All right. He was in deep contemplation, stuck somewhere between love for a girl and loyalty to ethic. We can't do this until I talk to Ethan, Messiah said. I want to do this, but I won't disrespect him. I can't. It's going against all the rules. She nodded and he pulled her close, kissing the tip of her nose as he pulled on her long braids, causing her to crane her neck backwards as his rough hands gripped her fragile neck. He kissed her again on the neck, and she lowered her gaze to look him in his eyes. This was the feeling that she was supposed to feel when she invited a man to explore her. She was positive now that Lucas had raped her. He had taken liberties over her body that she hadn't granted. This chemistry, this message, this silent permission that she was giving to Messiah was unmistakable. Lucas had taken her virginity, and it saddened her because now she couldn't give it to Messiah. Go upstairs and rest. You've been through enough today. Your head is all over the place. What feels right might not be right. If it's meant for us to fuck with each other, then it'll be. In the morning, I'll take you home, Messiah said. His lips were so beautiful to watch, and she was briefly grateful that she couldn't hear, because if she didn't have to look at them, she wondered if she would notice them at all. They were full and dark, as if he had smoked 100 blunts. She wondered how many women he had given the honor of tasting his lips. None. And a twinge of irrational jealousy ran through her. The way he bit his bottom lip and then licked them made her swoon as she sighed deeply while acknowledging his words. She walked away, looking back at him coyly before disappearing up the stairs. Messiah was going against everything he stood for, money over women. He had never thought twice about a female. They were good company at night, but none of the many he had sampled had ever brought him back for seconds. He hadn't even touched Morgan, and already he was ready to body niggas over her. That type of affection was scary. It was crazy and dangerous. It was irrational, but still, he felt it. It was forbidden, but he knew he was still going to pursue her. He pulled out his phone and sent a text to Ethic. If he was going to do this, he had to face his mentor, man to man. It was only right. He only hoped Morgan was worth it. And there's a break in the chapter. Hey, Kim Cash, happy Friday, darling. Welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Y'all be glad you just came in where you did, because, honey, you missed all the tragedy of the fuck shit. Just fool-la-la foolishness, child. Ugh. All right. Yes, heavy meat, child. Woo! The kickstand be real heavy. Oh my God. Anyway, you, girl. Oh, okay. You read it already, so you already know, okay? Yes, absolutely sad, Kim. Absolutely sad. Just, I'm like, come on, man. Yeah, child. Shit, that part happened in, I think it was chapter 3. Yeah, the first fucking chapter we read. Yeah, the first chapter that we read, honey. Just a mess. All right, let me get back at it. Darkness encompassed Ethic as he stepped into his home. The beep from his alarm system sounded lightly, causing a sleep Dolce to stir on the couch. I thought he said he asked Lily to watch them. Is Dolce the same as Lily?
I guess so, child.
It's late. Is everything okay? You called me over here and then you rushed out without explanation. She stood and walked over to him, his silhouette illuminated slightly by the light that filtered inside from the porch. She touched him, but pulled back when she felt something wet. "What is this?" she asked as she pulled her hands back and reached for the light switch. The gloom he wore on his face and the blood on his jacket were evidence of his wrongdoing. "Are you bleeding?" "It's not mine," he admitted. "Where are my kids?" he asked, suddenly feeling a sense of urgency to make sure they were okay. "They're upstairs sleeping." "They're fine," Dolce reassured as she frowned. "What happened?" "No questions," he answered, his voice dark. Sadness lived in his eyes, regret, anger, paranoia. It all reflected in his gaze as he looked at her. He had blood on his hands, and although he had killed before, he had never carried the guilt of a child's murder. He pulled off his clothes, unable to keep them on his body any longer. The stained hoodie felt like it was hot to the touch, as if it was the one act that had given the devil ownership of his soul. He stalked up the stairs. "Ethic!" Dolce called to his back as she picked up the clothes and followed him. He peeled out of his jeans and stepped right into the shower, turning the handle all the way to hot to scald the guilt away. He placed both hands on the wall in front of him and lowered his head as he watched the water swirl around the drain at his feet. He was spiraling. His life was like a tunnel, and the only light he saw at the end was the flames that waited to burn him for the mistakes he had made. His chest felt as if it had caved in, and he remembered the last time death had put this crippling feeling on him. It was the day he lost his mother. He was 7 years old when she had been murdered, and he had felt the same thing then that he felt this day: devastation. Utter loss. He felt Dolce's hands wrap around his body and he cringed. She just wanted to be near him. He just wanted to cast her away, but he turned around, water rinsing over him, falling into his eyes and on his face as he breathed deeply, his frustrations mounting. "What do you want from me?" he asked her. He saw confusion in her eyes and shock fill her face. "She don't even know," he thought. He often pondered about the motives of women. They had always been superficial creatures. Before he had been trapped in a burning car years ago, ladies had wanted him for his looks. Afterward, some sought him for his money. Others wanted to be that special one that he claimed. They wanted the power and the glory that came with being his. Dolce had been in the ring, fighting for the spot for a long time, but deep down he knew she was just more of the same. She wanted the title, nothing more. And if Ethic ever fell off, he knew she would flee. Her attraction was superficial, and suddenly he wanted to punish her for it. He flipped her around and pulled at her hips so that she was standing on her tiptoes. There was a slight arch in her back. "Take it out on me," she whispered in a throaty gasp as he entered her. She was there. She wanted to be fucked, so Ethic was going to pour his aggression, his anger into her. He was strong, wide, and hard as he dug into her, all raw passion, no finesse. He wasn't gentle. In fact, he was more than she could handle, his back shots causing her to bite down on her bottom lip. She took it because she knew he needed it, and it felt so miserably good. The mix of pain and pleasure that caused her to cry out when he hit the deepest parts of her was like nothing she had ever felt. She tried to run. "Take it," he whispered. Oh, God. His voice was almost pleading with her, begging her to take the remorse off his hands, as if he could transfer his fault to her through this act. It was non-transferable. The pain was his to bear. Only he was liable for what had occurred tonight, and he couldn't fuck his burdens away. He withdrew from her, growling in masculinity as he spilled his seeds, mixing it in the stream of water and washing his beautiful black babies down the drain. To Dolce's dismay, she had been trying to get Ethic to slip for years, knowing that he was the type of man that would never walk away from a woman who gave him children. Her attempts at entrapment were to no avail. He was always cautious, even when his mind was somewhere else. He washed his body and stepped out of the shower, wrapping a towel around his waist. "You know you can talk to me, right? About whatever happened, about whatever's hurting you," Dolce said as she turned off the water. "Talking about real shit has never been our thing. Why can't you just leave us where we are instead of trying to force us to a place where it's uncomfortable?" he said in frustration. He walked into the room. She was right on his heels. "Uncomfortable for whom?" Dolce challenged. "For you? Because this," she pointed between them, "this shit here is what makes me uncomfortable. I've been available to you for years, even after you brought that bitch Raven up in here. Who picked you up when you were drowning after she died? Then you go off to New York to take care of some new bitch, leaving me here just dropping what we have. I don't owe you any explanations. We're friends who fuck at times," Ethic replied. He knew it was a bit harsh. Normally he would spare her feelings, but she was picking on the wrong night. "And that's it? After all this time, that's all I am? A friend to you?" she asked. I didn't answer, or sorry, he didn't answer her as he slid into a pair of gray jogging pants, allowing them to hang low on his waist, exposing the deep V cuts that led to his girth. Yes, God. Ooh, child, we love that Adonis belt. That thing is a thing of beauty. Sorry. Even after sex, he hung noticeably in the sweatpants. Heavy beat. Just be heavy for nothing. Sorry. The print of thickness pronounced and distracting as Dolce yelled at him. He had checked out of the conversation. He didn't argue. The yelling and screaming, he wasn't beat for it. I never made you no promises, Ma, he said. Dolce scoffed. You selfish, arrogant motherfucker, she said, as she snatched up her clothes and put them on quickly. Next time you think to call me to come watch your kids or cook a meal or to suck your dick, don't. He watched her storm out and sat down at the foot of his king-size bed. He had so many things to deal with that remedying Dolce's hurt feelings was simply not a priority. And that's the end of that chapter. Let me tell you something. He gonna have to bean this bitch, because first of all, she knows where he and his children lay their heads. That's a dangerous thing. And now she knows he came home wearing bloody clothes. Like, and if news once the news of the murder hits the TV, I mean, I got a feeling it's gonna be some bullshit. He need to kill her immediately, if not fucking sooner. I don't know what sooner than immediately besides yesterday. Which he should have done already, but whatever, child. All right. Y'all know I be getting annoyed, child. All right, so I am ethic and his heavy meat and them fucking sweatpants. Oh Lord, but you cannot be a slave to the meat, ladies. I mean, you could be a slave when you get in the meat, but once you do get the meat, listen, act like the meat don't exist. Otherwise, child, you'd be a fucking sucker. Nope. Nope. Don't be traumatized by the dick. Traumatize that dick. That's what you do. Okay? Now, you heard me say it. I told you first, okay? Chapter six. Alani sat on her hands and knees, scrubbing, gripping the bristle brush so hard that her knuckles hurt as she tried to clean the blood stains out of her wooden floor. Her bloodshot eyes burned as she swiped at her tears with the back of her wrist. She had been crying for days. Her brother and her beautiful daughter were dead. She felt like she was drowning, trying to inhale air in a pool of water, and the slow suffocation was torture. Alani, let me help you, baby. You need to sleep. The voice behind her belonged to her Aunt Nanny. Normally, the soft alto, or alto, filled with wisdom and strength, was soothing to her, but today it was like nails on a chalkboard. She was irritated, taking her anger out on everyone around her as she mourned the loss of Lucas and her dear Kenzie. Sleep won't come, Nanny, she whispered, so I might as well be doing something. She scrubbed harder and harder, using so much elbow grease that she was breaking a sweat. This blood just won't come out, she shouted. She bowed her head and sobbed as she cried. Why is this happening? Ah, my baby is gone. I told Lucas that all his bullshit was gonna catch up to him. He was out here selling dope and throwing every dollar he made in the faces of every broke nigga in town. He was living foul, and it was only a matter of time before something went wrong. But that was his chance to take. It was his life. How did his karma come back on me, on Kinsey? She wailed. Confusion and grief caused her to double over. Her emotions were causing her physical pain. She could barely inhale. It hurt so bad. Alani just wanted to die because it would be much easier than being the only one left behind mourning. It's only by the grace of God that I didn't get shot that night, Nanny said as she sat down on the floor in front of Alani and grabbed the brush from her hands. She began to scrub at the stained wood. I know it hurts, baby, but I'm gonna love on you through the hurt. I'm right here with you. I've been with you since the day you were born, and as long as I live and breathe, you will always be okay. These are dark days, Alani, but there's always a light ahead. Keep your faith in God, Nanny said. What kind of God allows a 3-year-old girl to be murdered while she sleeps, huh? That's no God I trust. You may worship that type of God, but I won't. I can't. Alani said as she stood and stormed out of the house, snatching her purse up on the way out. She paused midway as she descended the steps. Her aunt was the only person she had left. She had never raised her voice at her. Guilt caused her to backtrack her steps as she went back inside. I'm sorry, Nanny, Alani said as she watched her aunt pick up the bucket and the brush from the floor. I know it's not all on you, though, Alani. I love them too. I feel it too. Ain't no point in us feeling it alone. We need one another to get through this. I just want to be here for you, baby, Annie said. Alani nodded as she teared up. She hated the way her emotions came in waves. It was up, then down. One minute she was mentally coaching herself to find strength, and the next she felt like the world had ended. She would never be able to make it through the planning of two funeral services. Have you seen the life insurance policy? She asked. Nanny looked at her sympathetically. It's in your hand, she replied. Alani looked down as if someone else gripped the folder. I'm losing it, she whispered. Don't be so hard on yourself. You want me to come with you to the funeral parlor? Alani shook her head. No, I gotta do this myself, she said, shaking her head. Seeing her daughter's body under the white sheet at the morgue had been the hardest thing she'd ever done. It was an image she would never forget. She was a mother burying her child. Nothing about that was right. She didn't need anyone witnessing her breakdowns. She was trying her hardest to keep her composure, to only fall to her knees behind the safety of closed doors, and to stifle her wails at night, face in her pillow. She just couldn't let anyone see the type of grief she was going through because it was teetering on the edge of crazy. She rushed out and jumped into her raggedy Pontiac G6. The car was so old that they didn't even make the model anymore. The reason she had even left her daughter in Lucas's care was so that she could pick up overtime hours to be able to save up for the down payment on a pretty little Jeep she had been daydreaming about. Pause. Your brother's the dope man of the South Side. And you out here working overtime to buy your own whip? The nigga couldn't front you? You know, like, the fuck? That's the least he could do is buy you a whip. He your brother. Ugh, anyway. It all seemed so selfish now, so pointless. She was worried about people in her city judging her, laughing at her for driving a bucket, and had lost time with her little girl chasing material things. She had left Kinsey with Lucas plenty of times before, always so she could work. But she now questioned if she was working to take care of her daughter or if the motive had truly been superficial. She had never thought it would result in such a tragedy. I'm to blame for all this, she thought. I should have moved Lucas out of Flint way before the streets got a hold of him, and I should have never left Kinsey with him. What was I thinking? She tried hard to never judge her brother, but not once had she taken a dime of his ill-gotten money. She had watched him slink lower and lower into the bowels of the city's underworld. I should have done more to stop it. Look what's happened because I sat around and did nothing at all, she thought. Her thoughts haunted her all the way to the funeral home. Even the sky seemed to be crying as she stepped out into the rain, holding a copy of Essence magazine over her head to stop her fresh wrap from turning into a full-blown afro. By the time she made it inside, she was soaked. Her hair started to fight her fresh press, reverting to her natural curls slightly. She huffed as she took the hair tie she wore around her wrist, used it to pull her hair into a tiny ponytail. I guess she never heard of a fucking umbrella. Anyway. She caught a glimpse of herself in the mirror in the reception area. Her puffy eyes and red nose were evidence of the sleepless nights she'd endured. She wore her melancholy all over her. Even her skin had lost its vibrant glow. She couldn't even imagine ever feeling true happiness again, not as a childless mother. How was she supposed to forget about the little girl that had grown in her womb? Surely she couldn't be expected to act as if she didn't know what it felt like to have two heartbeats at the same time. She felt like she had been given entrance into an exclusive club, only to suddenly be kicked out. Her motherhood had been stripped violently from her. Her legs weakened slightly as she suddenly had the urge to run back out into the rain. Ma'am, are you Miss Hill? Alani turned to find that the voice belonged to a black woman with sympathetic eyes. Alani could tell that it was a look that she supplied out of habit. The woman was in the business of burying people, of preparing the final goodbyes of the dead. She had rehearsed that compassionate stare long and hard. Alani could see the contrived kindness was nothing more than a job requirement. It was as common as a uniform or an ID badge. How you know, though, girl? Maybe the lady really was sympathetic. Alani wanted to slap the false sadness from the woman's face. She was so angry these days, angrier than she had ever been. She needed someone to blame. Without someone to take this hurt out on, it was eating her alive from the inside out. "I'm here to begin arrangements for my daughter and brother," she whispered. "They were brought here last night. Of course, we've been expecting you. Did you bring the insurance information?" the woman asked. Alani went into her bag and handed it over. "It's not a lot. I have $10,000 on each of them," she began to explain. "Don't worry, that's plenty. We'll work within your budget," the woman explained. "Come into our showroom. I'll introduce you to James. He'll be your coordinator. I'll go contact your insurance company while he gets you started with arrangements." Alani nodded as she was led through a double door where a man was waiting for her. She stepped over the threshold into what seemed like a world of flowers and caskets. "Alani, this is the owner, James Masters." "That's weird. I know somebody named James Masters, but they don't live in Detroit. But anyway, I'm going to handle the paperwork." "He'll take care of you. You're in good hands," the woman said. "That you are," he said. Alani took in his expensive suit, fake smile, and his greasy hair. His brown skin matched hers, but it was a shade richer, which let her know he wasn't from where she was from. He was the type of person who built his business in the hood, but wouldn't dare live there. He was getting rich based on the deaths, often murders, of Black people, and Alani wasn't naive to the fact. "Let's sit," he offered, as he grabbed a book from atop of one of the fancy caskets and took a seat beside her. They flipped through the options, and Alani felt instant intimidation from the prices. It seemed that even the simplest details were $1,000 and up. She went through the book, not even eyeing the makes of the caskets or the type of flowers, but noticing the prices. Her heart was full of angst. She never knew that it was so expensive to put a loved one to rest. "I can't afford any of this, even with the insurance," she thought, dismayed. She wanted to do her brother and daughter justice, and tears pooled in her eyes. "You want the best for your daughter. This rose gold pink aluminum casket is a great option. It'll never decay. It'll withstand the elements well. I have mothers coming here, and all they're thinking about is getting change from that insurance policy, but I know a good mother when I see one. This is perfect for your angel," he said. "He a asshole, y'all, playing on her motherfucking emotions, cocksucking bastard. That's terrible, y'all. That's terrible. Ugh, tell me he see people coming in looking for a little bit of change from the policy. And why not, sir? But damn, you ain't got to sell her no, you know, he overselling." She looked at him, her lip trembling. He was selling her hard, his voice full of awe, as if he was peddling her a brand new car instead of a box that would go in the ground filled with her most precious possession in the world. She was overly emotional. Her hands shook as she turned the pages, desperately hoping that the next page would reveal something, anything that was within her range. It was costing her more to bury her daughter than it had to Bertha. Death was more expensive than life, and this man was too eager, too pushy. He held no remorse, no timidity about broaching the sensitive subject. This man had no shame about measuring her love for her kid based on what she chose out of this high-ass book. Alani felt like a failure. The woman from before, the wearer of the fake smile, knocked on the door softly before poking her head inside the room. "Miss Hill, can I speak with you for a moment?" she said. Alani was grateful to be tapped out of the rain. She stood to her feet, finally having an excuse to run from the room. As she stepped into the hall, the woman's expression caused Alani to frown. "Your insurance company says the policy has lapsed. You don't have a current life insurance policy. Is there another policy, perhaps at home?" the woman asked. "What do you mean? I pay this policy every month," Alani whispered, her face heaving with embarrassment. "I'm only delivering the information as it's told to me," the woman replied. She handed Alani the documents back. "You can call them to find out more. Can you take a loan from the bank or a family member in the meantime to cover the burial expenses?" Alani snatched the papers out of the woman's hands. "There's no one. It's just me. It's always on me," she mumbled those last words as she gathered her shame. "I need to call about the policy. I'll be back." The rain welcomed her back. This time she was grateful for it. It mixed with her tears, helping to hide her torment as she rushed back to her car. She pulled out a phone, but as she went to dial the number on the rain-stained papers, she heard the automated voice echo in her ear. "Please contact AT&T about your account." Damn! "Girl, you better get some of that fucking dirty ass money from your dead brother, bitch. I'm sure he caked up." Mm-mm. Wow. I'm so fucking ignorant. Saki, you're on a live stream. My God. Okay. Alani tossed the phone at the dashboard as frustration mounted as she gripped her steering wheel in ire. Nothing could ever be easy. Every day was always one big struggle. She was always behind, always robbing Peter to pay Paul, always playing catch up. She had managed over the years. She had always been able to make the pieces to the puzzle fit. Sure, things were paid late, but they were always paid. This time, she didn't know if she would be able to pull it off. Her mind wasn't even in the right state for her to think of how to make the impossible possible. Right now, she just wanted to have a hall pass, not to cheat, but to cry. It seemed Black women were never given that luxury of emotional release. Big facts. Y'all, we ain't allowed to break down, to have a fucking headache, to have a backache, or to have a menstrual cramp. We just got to keep on pushing. We don't get to have an emotional day where we just lay around and boo-hoo cry. You better go take a nap right quick, bitch, and get right back at it. I don't know why that's put on us like that. Anyway. Her mind was submerged in grief, and that blocked all logical thought. All she knew was that she didn't have the money she needed, and the fact that her daughter and brother were lying on a cold slab waiting for her to come to the rescue was damaging to her soul. She'd always been their nurturer, their problem solver, and now she felt useless. She found a car key and went to turn over the ignition. The sound of it revving and then stalling caused her to laugh. Of course, she said in disbelief, her car wasn't starting. When it rains, it fucking pours. She exited the car. Her embarrassment kept her from going back inside, so she trekked through the rain across the street to the diner on the corner. She wasn't reminded that she hadn't eaten until the smell of bacon caused her stomach to growl as she stepped inside. She sat at the bar and motioned to the waitress serving the early morning patrons. Is there a phone I can use? My car stalled across the street. I need to call a tow, she said. You gotta buy something first, the waitress replied. That's fine, Alani said. She looked up at the sign. $3.99 breakfast special. She needed every little dollar at this point. The $4 she was about to spend on one breakfast could buy her a whole pack of bacon that she could eat on all week, but her stomach urged her to feed it. $4 ain't gonna make a difference, she thought. I'll take the special and a phone, she said, her testy tone causing the woman to roll her eyes. She handed over the old school phone, stretching the curly cord to the max so that Alani could use it. Bitch is gonna spit in my food, Alani thought. As she took the receiver, wishing that she had been a bit nicer with her tone. A good breakfast would stop her stomach from touching her back, ease the sick feeling that had lived within her since finding out about the deaths of her loved ones. Or so she hoped. She hooked up to Wi-Fi and searched for the closest company. The waitress sat down her food as she ordered the tow. Alani eyed the food suspiciously, opting out of eating as she placed exactly $4 on the countertop before heading back out into the rain. No, that woman ain't spitting that food, shit. I hope not. I probably should go back and ask. I'm just playing. But there's a break in the chapter, y'all. Ethic's hands were covered in motor oil as he installed the carburetor into an old school Buick Regal. Oh yes, God, I loves me an old school Buick Regal or Monte Carlo. Child, listen. Ooh, and that's special too. The Century, the Buick Century special. Ooh, child. Anyway. Sorry. He had to focus on something, on anything, to stop himself from thinking about the little girl's life he had taken, albeit it had been a mistake. Those types of slip-ups were ones that didn't go without fault. Someone had to shoulder the blame for the loss of life. The world was filled with enough evil. He had taken one of the good ones, and now his soul was unbalanced. His spirit was disturbed, and nothing but busy work could keep him from losing it. One of his many investments over the years had been a distribution trucking company and a string of automotive shops around the state of Michigan. It was rare that the boss came in to get his hands dirty, but today he needed to do something, anything, to keep his thoughts from haunting him. Rebuilding the beautiful American-made machine was like putting a puzzle together. It took all of his concentration, and he often blocked out everything around him until the entire picture was complete. He had salvaged the car from the junkyard years ago, and he was putting it together piece by piece. We got one coming in, he heard one of his workers shout out, and he lifted his head as he noticed a tow truck pull in front of his breath. His gut wrenched when he saw her step out of the passenger seat of the tow truck. He instantly recognized her. Her hair was a curly mess on top of her head as she ducked under the handbag she held above her head. Her eyes were swollen and red. Still, he noticed the beauty in her as she rushed inside the lobby to shelter from the rain. Her skin was smooth, resembling coffee that had been diluted with milk, and her slim build was complemented with wide hips and bowed legs. Even in her obvious distress, she carried an effortless beauty. What is she doing here? He thought, as alarm filled him, and he held his breath, her presence ordering him to cease all movement. Her story had headlined the news. Mother loses daughter, sister loses brother to gun violence, marks the city's 50th murder. Even if he had missed the story that the media played on a loop, her face matched a face he had seen before. It was an older replica of the little girl that he had stripped from the earth. He stared at the woman walking into his establishment and knew the universe was playing a cruel trick on him. If he had thought he had found respite from his guilt, this face, this woman was there to destroy all possibility of that. Even if he hadn't been the hidden figure behind the trigger, he would have noticed her. He had learned to ignore the sound of the bell above the door, but she captivated his attention. She was just one of those people, hard to miss, as was the pain in her bloodshot eyes. Sorrow filled him because he was unknowingly disrespecting her space. She was standing mere feet away from the murderer of her child, of her brother, and guilt riddled him like bullets. He was surprised the emotional shots he took didn't cause him to bleed out right there in the body shop. He hurt with her, for her, as if she was his beloved to mourn beside. Ethic had never been so silently remorseful. He was used to righting his wrongs, to remedying things he had broken. A real man knew when to apologize and acknowledge his wrong. He felt like a little ass boy standing there, allowing her to remain in the dark about his actions. There was no way to repair this. There was nothing he could do or say that would lessen her agony. He couldn't speak an apology, because to do so would incriminate him. As he blinked, the momentary darkness reminded him of Bella, of Easy, and of Morgan. Each of their faces flashed behind his lids with every blink. They depended on him. To confess his sins would force him to leave his children behind. He just couldn't do it. And he felt like the lowest of the low, a coward, a murderer. No admission of guilt would come from his mouth, which meant no apology between them could exist. The air thickened around him, and Ethic wiped his hands on the towel beside him and bypassed her as he walked into the back office. It was time for him to break out. With her there, the distraction he sought was no more. There wasn't one big enough anyway to stop him from seeing blood on his hands. He went to the sink and washed his hands, but as the black grime rinsed down the drain, all he could see was red. Yo, boss, we got a problem out here. Ethic looked up as Redneck Larry peeked his head into the office. You can't handle it? Ethic asked. She asked for the owner, Larry said. Ethic's throat constricted as he reached for the paper towel to dry his hands. Did she know? Did she have supernatural abilities to detect his guilt? Was her motherhood like an internal compass that helped her find her daughter's offender? Ethic was a man whom had faced many things, but this petite woman made him feel like he was a peasant who was preparing to meet the evil queen. How mighty would her wrath be? Logic told him that he had been careful, that there was no way she could identify him, but remorse was a hungry beast and his conscience was feeding it. Boss? Ethic snapped from his thoughts and stepped out of the office. For some reason, he felt disrespectful greeting her with grease smeared on his forearms and the coveralls only half casing him, his strong chest only covered by the dirty wife beater he wore. He looked like a blue-collar worker who made honest money, but as he shook her hand, the softness of his well-manicured hands told a different story. The hair rose on the back of his neck at their brief connection because he knew his was the last hand she would want to grasp. The ball in his throat made him swallow deeply, moving his Adam's apple as he wiped the top of his head, smoothing out his waves. Ooh, heavy meat and deep waves. Oh, Lord. Ethic was nervous. He had crossed many gangsters in his lifetime, none of which had ever made him sweat. This woman made him uneasy with nothing more than her presence. He felt transparent standing before her. What can I do for you? He asked. Listen, I wanted to talk to you about giving me a discount on the price of my car being repaired. I literally am having the worst week of my life. I'm not trying to give you no sob stories, but my shit is fucked up. My daughter died, my brother died. I'm missing work to plan the funerals. The insurance people own some bullshit, and my car broke down outside the funeral home. I can't afford to fix this car, but I can work it off, sweep up around here, something, scrub toilets, anything. I just really need God to send me an angel right now because if one more thing goes wrong, I'm gonna lose it. What do you say? She had to laugh at how ridiculous it sounded, but it was all true. No exaggeration needed. Her life was in shambles. She was in shambles, and as she stood pleading with ethics, she laughed. She gripped her stomach in laughter as tears came to her eyes. I'm sorry, she said in between laughing fits. This is just so ridiculous. How can life get this bad? I mean, I've been praying and praying. I just find it funny that I'm praying to the same God that allowed this to happen in the first place. Shit's hilarious. Her laughter faded as she planted her face in her hands. She turned away from him in embarrassment. You know what? Never mind, she whispered. She faced him now, taking a deep breath and squaring her defeated shoulders as she cleared her throat. This ain't your problem, and I've never begged for anything in my life. I'll come up with the money. Can you just have it done as soon as possible? She asked. He watched her as she stood in front of him. Her eyes were sad, but challenge lived behind her stare as if she were determined to survive. Her hand was cocked on one of her hips, and her face twisted in anger and frustration. Glistens of tears danced in her eyes, and she was trying so hard to be strong that her bottom lip quivered. Her vulnerability and sadness were the most exquisite thing ethic had ever seen. Her femininity was a work of art. She was beauty, a shattered kind that was broken and all over the place, but beautiful all the same. He would have obliged her, even if he wasn't the one responsible for the havoc in her life. Fix her car, Ethic said as he turned to exit. What's the discount? Redneck Larry asked. It's on the house, Ethic replied. He reached the door and looked back, just in time to see her eyes widen in shock and her shoulders slag slightly as if he had physically removed a weight from them. Her burden was visible and palpable. He could feel it. The energy she carried left no room for anything but woe, and he understood, but she was infectious. Seeing his actions affect this woman disturbed him. I swear on my life, I'll pay you back. I just need a little time. Thank you, she said as she took a step toward him, hands pressed together as if he had answered one of her many prayers. He backed up from her, abruptly pushing the door open with force as he crossed the parking lot to his car. He had to get away from her, out of her reach, out of her sight. He started his car and pulled away from his business in haste. He could see her step out of the building to watch him leave, but he wanted nothing but distance between them. She was a reminder of his greatest sin, and he knew that the irony of her walking into his shop on the rare day that he was present was nothing but God reminding him that he had lost his way. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, Lord have mercy. I don't even smoke weed, but I need a blunt and a drink. Shit. Oh my God, this book is too much. Oh my God. Oh Lord, hamburger and French fries, child. Listen, Linda. Nordic, what time you get off so I can make sure I'm outside your job? I'm gonna stump a mud hole in your ass. Oh my God. Oh Lord. The hell you got me up here reading, girl. I like it though. I ain't gonna even front. I like it. I'm guessing y'all like it too. Shit, y'all still here. We don't get a big crowd over here in the Speakeasy, and that's the way we like it. We like a old hole in the wall that don't nobody know about. We are YouTube's best kept secret. We be talking cash money shit over here about bitches and bastards in books, not real people. We save that for the kick in the Willy Bobo. These are real people that are used to getting talked about anyway. But even that is peppered with empathy and compassion, humility. I do take a few pot shots at some of these fucked up celebrities because they got the money to get therapy, but they cocksucking asses just won't fucking do it. Sorry, bastards, but they dripping in labels from companies that don't even like black people. Like, I ain't never seen so many celebrities with G's all over them. Let me tell you something. Gucci don't like niggas. Stop buying their shit. Stop. Y'all spend more money on their shit. Guess what it is, dumbass? Free advertisement. I hope they cut you a deal. I hope they sending you a check for all the free promotion, dumbass. And the niggas who go buy it because you see some heifer on the Housewives wearing it. I just saw fucking, what's my little baby from Chicago? I like her a lot. I guess because we both from Chicago. I don't know. But anyway, Drew Sidora, she's standing around with a goddamn Gucci headscarf on her head. Bitch, if you don't take that shit off, I'd rather see you with a Walmart bandana on your head. At least they hire black folks. Hell, shit. Get a damn bandana for somebody to screen print it and it say Drew Sidora. Hell, do that. But stop making white folks that don't give a fuck about you and don't like your black ass, okay? Would tell you flat out, our shit ain't for you. You bring the value of it down because of the fuck shit you do while you're wearing it. You making them richer because they ain't giving you that shit for free. No. Listen. Oh, God. Oh, I cannot. Y'all, back in the day, the only people that I saw with Gucci was rich black folks that were trying very hard to ingratiate themselves into the good graces of white folks. And when I used to walk around downtown, especially, in the summertime, you get off work and you're walking around up and down Michigan Avenue or State Street. It was just a smattering of folks that had on something Gucci, like a Gucci handbag or a little, the little Gucci wallet or whatever. It was them women that worked for the government, honey, and they were usually the supervisors, baby, and they wanted to shit on the people that, did the grunt work. It was the girlfriends and side pieces of the dope boys, from the South Side, the North Side, and the West Side, yeah. And over there in East Indiana, they would come on over there too, but it was white women that had the Gucci bags and the Louis Vuitton bags. I never really understood it. I never wanted anything Gucci, and I promise you, I never bought their shit. I never wanted anything Louis Vuitton, and I never bought their shit. No. You'll never see me with anything Gucci, and if somebody give me something Gucci, I'm gonna give it right back. Keep your motherfucking money. Louis Vuitton, don't want it. Nope. No. Give me a nice Dooney and Burke all-weather leather bag. I don't need no letters on it. It can have a fucking duck, or it could just have the DB on it. It don't matter to me. But I don't need all the, pizzazz because I really don't like to do free advertising. But they did give me a purse that matched my car because I told them, y'all need to make a bag because I drive a purple Mercedes. I ordered enough shit from y'all. You motherfuckers owe me a fucking purple bag. And do you know? I promise you, on all I love, that was 2009, baby. A purple Dooney and Burke bag showed up on my motherfucking doorstep. Motherfucking UPS man rang the doorbell, baby. Sure did. Right. And it matched my car perfectly. I was like, yes, they heard me. They should have shit. You know how many bags I used to order from their asses? Oh, listen, get your ass out of here. But this is terrible. I hate to see folks walking around advertising like that. Now we done got all the way off. This done turned into a kick in the Willy Bobo. I'm sorry, y'all. So anyway, that's the only time that we talk shit about folks, child. Listen, that's it. That's all. Okay. Other than that, yeah, you ain't gonna get it over here. Cause I really I don't do that type of bullshit. Stop doing the free advertising for these folks. Advertise your own shit. That's what. All right, so let me get the time stamp for this next thing, child. I'm doing pretty good, y'all. But these chapters be long as shit. All right. Chapter 7. The emotions that dwelled within the chambers of an 18-year-old girl's heart were so intense. They were like a cosmic force in the universe, spinning and burning and building to an intensity so brilliant that its inevitability of explosion couldn't be avoided. Oh, God. Morgan sat on her bed, her body sinking into the plush mattress so deeply that it muffled her cries. The gloom of the rainy day matched her somber mood, creating the perfect soundtrack to her melancholy as beads of water slid down the window pane. She felt everything, every emotion. They hit her all at once, simultaneously torturing her weary young heart. Her need for him attacked her. He hadn't called. He hadn't responded to her texts. She had been torturing herself for days, checking her phone every few minutes, only to feel the sting of letdown when his name was never present on her screen. Messiah was MIA, and she felt like she was being detoxed off a drug so strong that without it, she would die. He had only given her a taste of his attention, a morsel of his affection, and already she was willing to do anything for more. Young love was potent, like crack to a dope fiend, like relaxer to new growth, like good dick to a nympho. Yes, God. Sorry. Like chocolate during a menstrual cycle. When you needed it, you needed it. She saw the light in her room flicker on, then off, and she turned to see Ethic standing in the doorway. She sighed. She had wondered when he would speak to her. It had been days and he hadn't uttered one word. His silence was almost worse than any punishment he could come up with. It took a lot to make Ethic mad, but he was brooding. His demeanor filled the house with anxiety as she waited. She was tired of the daddy role. When she was younger, she needed him. She wanted his guidance. She respected his role as patriarch in her life. It was old and stale at 18, however. She wanted the leash removed. Well, bitch, look what happened the last time he unfurled it just a little bit. You went out here and... That's not victim blaming, y'all. It's not. She went out and she made bad decisions. She didn't follow her gut. That's the only thing I fault her for. When your gut tell you to grab that motherfucking lock and open that door and jump out, I don't give a fuck how fast the truck going. Your bruises will heal, your external bruises. That internal scarring that she got now after this assault, what happened to her? Two times? In the same night, plus the betrayal of her bitch-ass so-called best friend, that's some shit that ain't gonna never heal. That's why I say about these nigga-fied nigga bitches that be out here pretending, oh, I'm your friend, I'm your friend, I'm your friend, I'm your friend. They setting your ass up to do this type of dirt right here. That's the shit that I be talking about when I be telling you, make sure you don't fuck with grimy bitches like her friend. That's a grimy ass person. That's why I didn't like reading that book, Dirty to the Grave, because them hoes were skinning and grinning in her face, setting that damn girl up for downfall. Oh, I can't. All right. All right. She respected his role as a patriarch. Yeah. But now she wanted the leash removed. She had been walking around on eggshells because his disappointment was like carrying around a heavy weight that only he could relieve her of. She don't even realize that he ain't said shit because he is torn up inside that while he was out there avenging her being sexually assaulted, he killed somebody's fucking innocent child. She always thinking that it's all about her. Open your fucking mouth and say something. Well, open your fingers and use your fingers and talk, bitch. Say something. Snap a finger. Oh, my God. All right. If he truly was her father, she would want his approval. But Morgan just wanted him to leave her alone and give her space to become whomever it was she was meant to be, whether it was fucked up or not. What do you want? She signed. Ethic folded his arms over his broad, strong chest. I don't know what to do with you at this point, Morgan, he signed back. I never asked you to do anything. You chose to take me in. You're not my father. Her hands were moving so fast that he knew she was upset. But I'm your family. Family is about more than blood, and I want to keep you safe. Messiah ain't safe. Choosing to go to the motel with a nigga you didn't know wasn't safe. Someone intentionally hurt you, and there was a price to pay for that. Messiah won't hurt you like that, but he lives a lifestyle that he can't protect you from. If something happens to you because of him, at the hands of him, or anyone who has a problem with him, Ethic paused because he could feel his temper returning. He's not an exception, is all I'm saying. When you hurt, others get hurt. And this time, someone innocent was affected behind bad decisions you made, Morgan, Ethic signed, as his thoughts went to the little girl lying cold in a casket. Speculation had already spread around the city about the murders. Morgan didn't know exactly what had occurred, but she knew that Ethic was behind both Lucas's murder and the little girl whose face had been on nightly news on repeat. Morgan was young, however, and she didn't quite value life in the same way Ethic did. That little girl's death is on Lucas. His karma got her killed, she thought. What about my hurt? What about what was taken from me? Morgan signed. He had me pinned against a wall. He was inside me and I couldn't even say no. No one hears me. No one sees me. I'm just Benjamin Atkins's pretty, deaf, dumb daughter. Messiah sees me. Messiah is no good for you, Ethic replied with sympathy. He pulled a pamphlet out of his back pocket. My position isn't changing about him. I know you feel different and you act out because you want to bop around here like your little friends. Everybody sees you, Morgan. We hear you. I hear you. I believe that there's a queen in there and you're trying to dumb yourself down to be like everybody else. You not being able to hear allows you to look at the world through a different lens. I respect your perspective, Morgan, but I know that everything is harder for you. I know there's a part of you that I can never understand. They ain't addressed her bitch-ass friend yet or the nigga that raped her anally. When are we going to talk about that? Oh, yeah. Listen, devil. Y'all just don't know. I be over here, motherfucking. Yes, she is just like Raven. Yes, snap your fingers or something. Y'all don't even realize, child. You know, you do not like to Because some people will look at you and go, oh my God, you're blaming the victim. And I am one for not victim blaming. Because no matter what you do, men should be able to control themselves and not assault you. I don't give a damn. Who's dead, right? Lucas is dead, but the guy that anally penetrated her is not. Ain't nobody said shit about him. They just killed Lucas. What about the other guy? Did she even tell anybody that there was a second guy who poked her in the poop pipe? Nobody, he should be shot too. Jamming the silencer up his butthole and pull the trigger. Yes, I'm real graphic with it. That's what I'm talking about. Blow the shit out of his brains. Exactly. That part. I want to see it pop out the top of his fucking... I'm bad, y'all, because I don't like violence against women. I really don't. Yeah, no, Lucas did it the first time and took her virginity. But the second guy, the one that was supposed to be with Niche, he's the one that anally penetrated her. That was him. He's the one that did that. So nobody has said anything about him. So he just running around here like a slow bopper for Christ, getting away with anally penetrating somebody and damn near killing her because he was choking her out from behind. You know? And I just don't get it. I really don't get it. I'm annoyed. This is like, So to my original point, women should be able to walk around ass naked in front of men without fear of being assaulted. Because as a man, you're supposed to be able to control your own shit. You do not take what no one has offered to you, okay? And if you do, you should have your ping cut off and stuffed up your rectum and then your head shoved up behind that. Absolutely. I really feel that. I would have been wonderful at Japanese torture. I'm telling y'all, I don't play. Not about that. No God. Okay? So, but Morgan keeps being out here just like her sister Raven. I got a point to prove. I'm going to do what I want to do. And now, look at what has happened to her. And then she didn't follow her gut. And she's still feeling like Ethic is like he too overbearing, girl. He trying to protect you. Mm-hmm. And she too dumb. Oh my God, so she oils be. I think you mean she could be, yeah. No, uh-uh. Nope. That last sentence, no ma'am. Mm-mm. No ma'am. You can run. You should be able to run around ass naked, and a man should be able to keep his hands to himself. He still don't have a right to do that. He don't have the right to touch you. No. That's that conversation that's necessary. But what has been inculcated into us is that somehow we are responsible for keeping men from assaulting us. We got to cover up. We can't show our shapes. We can't, you know, we're not supposed to be too aggressive or too coy. We can't act like we want something or don't want something. We're just supposed to be just fucking robots around here. No, God. Mm-mm. No. Because women get assaulted wearing burkas, okay? That's the thing that cover you completely up. Rape culture is alive and thriving on this big blue marble. I'm not just gonna say in this country, it's all around the world. All around the world. Keep your fucking hands and your raggedy ass peen to yourself. If I don't tell you I want it, then you keep that fucker over there. Okay? That's how that works. You know, to me, it's been made okay for them to do whatever they want to do to us, and somehow we're to blame. And that is that patriarchal bullshit that we've all just decided, well, we just might as well just bow down. You know, boys will be bullshit. Boys will have hard times pissing in a Foley bag fucking with me. Try it if you want to. I'm going to cut your shit clean the fuck off. And you're going to need a colostomy bag. I'm going to put my fist up your asshole and tie your damn colon into a slip knot. So you're going to need a Foley bag and you're going to need a colostomy bag. You're going to beg me to fucking put your lights out. Like, don't do that. Mm-mm. No. No, I know you never said that we need to dress like matrons. No. No, it don't matter. It don't matter. It's just, Marva, I can't even... I don't even have the time during this live stream to explain to you, honey, where the thought process that you're having comes from. It comes from an old school way of thinking that gets passed down to us. I remember it when I was a young girl. A girl in our neighborhood was walking from one friend's house studying on her way home, and somebody snatched her and assaulted her. Okay? And they did it outside. There was no secret place. They just, behind some bushes, just did it. And the first thing, all the older women in the neighborhood, well, what was she doing out that time of night? I don't give a motherfucking motherfuck what time of night it is. I should be able to walk up and down the street. What the fuck is wrong with you? And then, well, what does she have on? Why does she have on short shorts? She could have been ass naked. Your mama and your daddy didn't teach you, sir, not to rape women. That this is the shit I'm talking about. Our mothers and fathers taught us how not to be raped. But the mothers and fathers of the raping ass men didn't teach their sons not to rape women. And that's the fucking problem. So we, as women in our 50s, what do? We say these young girls shouldn't be running around here half-ass naked. They gonna have somebody. No. No, men should not be taught that it's okay for them to assault women. It's not. It should not be, well, boys will be boys. No, you rape, we cut your dick off. How about that? You'll see the number of rapes sharply decrease, but the lawmakers ain't gonna have that because a whole lot of them got a whole lot of rapey McRape pants bullshit in their fucking histories as well. Think I'm bullshitting? Let's do a quick Google search. A lot of them probably have been. Anyway, child, listen. Let me tell you something. Teach your sons to respect boundaries. Teach your sons to respect women and the culture of sexual assault against women and children will sharply decline. But people ain't doing that. Hell, they can't even, they can't teach themselves not to go back for whatever it is that they're doing. So how they passing it? You got a whole bunch of fucked up people raising children to be what? Fucked up. Mm-hmm. A lot of these parents ain't even out here raising their children. They're just allowing their children to age chronologically while in their care. The days of parents are gone. These motherfuckers ain't out here parenting. They don't know how. Nobody parented them. I thank the universe every day for every old ass woman that ever spoke a word into me, that ever poured into me. Because they were women that didn't take no shit, you heard me? They didn't take no shit. So they raised me to be what they call a hard Hannah, because that's what the fuck I am. I'm hard on these niggas. I'm hard on these bitches. I'm hard on children. Yes, I am. Your ass gonna be raised right around me, or you're gonna get the fuck on. Period, point blank. I will ring your fucking bell. Yes, I will. That's not abuse. That's discipline. I don't believe in abusing children, but I will discipline the fuck out of you and the fuck shit with it. I sure will. But people still out here on that baby boy, mama gotta have a life too. You finger popping and hip swinging. No, ma'am. When you decide to become somebody's mother, ma'am, yeah, you don't get to fucking swing your hips until that child is out the door and shit. Sometimes they come back. Right. So, yeah, it's a lifetime commitment. And half you motherfuckers can't even commit to a goddamn cell phone plan, let alone be somebody's fucking parent. You don't get to give the little motherfucker back when it becomes just too much to be their mommy. Get the fuck. Oh my God, y'all. We are in the. Oh my God. This is not supposed to be, y'all. What are we doing here? This is why I said sometimes. Oh, I should just be coming out here just talking to y'all. But no, Marva, that's where that mentality comes from. Oh, a woman needs to cover up to keep it. Girl, you could walk outside right now in with your body covered from head to toe in fucking cowhide. And if a motherfucker decides that today is the day that he gonna take him some good cootamagoota, then he is going to take it from you. He will rip that fucking cowhide off of you, throw your ass down in the back seat of his fucking Jeep, and he'll swing an episode. And it won't be an episode that you'll like. Trust me. And that's if he got a Jeep. Okay? So it should not be said that, oh, walking around here with your ass, I should be able to walk around here with fucking dental floss across my nipples and tween my crotch if that's all I want to put on. Okay? And you should keep your fucking hands to yourself, sir. You should keep your fucking hands to yourself. And if your mama didn't teach you, then perhaps this hot lead will. I'll be happy to throw some hot lead at you. I sure would. Yeah. It take bands to make bitches dance in the strip club, but it take bullets to make niggas dance when they doing some fuck shit. I don't give a damn. No God. So yeah, that comes from a long, long, long line of women just basically just taking it, just succumbing to patriarchal rule. And it's sad because women are still believing that shit to this day. And now the women that are my age in their 50s and some of them in their 40s are just saying, fuck it. It ain't nothing we can do with these kids. So just let them run wild, honey. Let them do whatever. And that's exactly what they're doing. You know? So I was raised different, and I have a different set of rules that I play by. I don't go for the fuck shit. Yeah, so no. I mean, but the bullshit that's inculcated into us in the black community, like I wish I don't even have time to go into all of the shit. I'm gonna just put this to y'all. Think about the last time you went to Walmart. What ethnicity were the children that were running around through the store losing their shit? Now, I'm not talking about at Christmas time, because I believe all children should be allowed to lose their shit in Walmart at Christmas time, because it's Christmas time. They're trying to figure out what the fuck it is they want to tell Santa Claus to bring them. Okay, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about just when you just went in there, you know, the grocery shop, you done got off work, you want to make some good sketti. Not spaghetti, some sketti, right? You're gonna run into Walmart, okay? You're gonna stay in the grocery section because you know when you go over to that fucking home goods section, you're gonna pick up too many fucking towels, too many packs of goddamn toilet paper. You're gonna get pot holders and shit you don't need, fucking oven mitts, a brand new mixer, and a whole bunch of other whatnots, as my little sister liked to call it. Don't fuck around over there. Stick to the grocery side. You're gonna get your meat. You're gonna get your noodles. I know y'all ain't making no sauce from scratch, so you're gonna get the ragu or the whatever that other shit is. I don't know, because I don't use none of that shit, okay? So you're gonna get all of that shit, right? You're gonna do all that. And what do you hear happening? Who is in the store falling the fuck out, acting a complete fucking donkey? And what children do you see that are trying their best to be well behaved? Oh, but peer pressure is a motherfucker, especially on little children, right? It's not little black children. Mm-mm. Now, I'm not talking about on the first of the month when the ladies is coming in there to get three, four, and six carts of groceries. God love them, honey, because they got to do that with their children in tow. So, yes, you expect the kids to act a donkey at that point as well, right? Because you get tired of walking down the fucking store, up and down the aisles, and she letting some nigga tell her what to put in the cart and not you. You want goddamn Fruit Loops, but she buying him Frosted Flakes, but that's what the fuck he like, and she telling you to go get you some Fruit Rings. Ain't that a bitch? But that's another fucking story for another fucking day. Anyway, I'm not talking about that because that's torture for a child to be in the store on EBT day. Leave your children with somebody that you trust and get your ass in there, get what you need, and get the fuck on out, okay? I'm talking about just regular, degular, schmegular shopping day. It's not black children falling out in the floor. Why? Because black children are taught, don't take your ass in this goddamn store and embarrass me. You see little Hispanic children falling on the floor acting a fucking donkey. You see little Caucasoid children falling on the floor acting a complete fucking donkey. You see little Middle Eastern children falling on the floor acting a fucking donkey. But little Jaquan, he see all the little homies falling out and he want to fall out too. But he hold on to that goddamn cart or that purse string because he know that he will catch a backhand with the LA motherfucking quickness. That's the shit I'm talking about. Little black children are taught, you don't get to be a kid when we're out in public. Children of other ethnicities are not taught that. That restriction is not put on them. Only black children are taught how they supposed to act out in public. They're supposed to act like fucking kids because that's what the fuck kids do. You know what children should be taught when they go into the store? Don't touch anything. That's what they should be taught. But if they're tired, or they're bored, or whatever, they're gonna act out. They're fucking children. But that's not the shit. Yeah, Caucasoid. Kay said, what did you say? The Caucasoid? Yes. So, you know, children should be taught not to touch shit because when children get to touching shit, whole fucking pyramids of soup cans fall to the floor. I'm not telling you about what I heard. I'm telling you about what I know because there was this one time my mama took me to Jewel. Jewel is a chain of grocery stores in Illinois. And they had all these Campbell soup cans up in a pyramid. That's tempting to a kid. So I just said, well, what would happen if I pull this one out? Baby, that hole you dig just came tumbling down. Same thing happened with all the oranges. You pick the wrong orange, they all slide to the floor. And grapefruits and tomatoes. Why do they put that shit on a hill like that anyway? Why the fuck would you do that? Don't do that. It's tempting to children. So that's the reason why children should be taught to keep their hands to themselves and don't touch anything when they're in the store. But that's it. But black children are taught how to behave in public. They're expected to know what to do, to think like an adult, to behave like an adult, to respond like an adult. It's a fucking child. But only black children have that expectation put on them. Children of other ethnicities are allowed to respond in whatever way it is that children do. Nobody says a fucking thing. Think about it. When you be in the fucking store and you standing in line trying to self-checkout, when you start going, somebody shut that fucking kid up. It's not a black child that you're saying that shit about. Argue with your ugly ass next door neighbor. I'm telling you, it's not a black child. If that black child is crying, it's because they're tired, hungry, and pissed the fuck off because this bitch done Uncle Ray throw 13 packs of fucking chicken gizzards in the car, but not the pack of fucking hot dogs that I wanted. I wanted the party pups, right? That's why the kid is upset, but that's it. So, you know, that's the shit that gets, that's what the black community does to its people, to its women, We're taught how we're supposed to behave, dress, think, act, respond, or not. Black girls, black boys, black children. And then who tells black men how to respond? I'm gonna stop right there because this live will turn into something else. Because y'all know I don't see it for them motherfuckers. I don't. All right? Married or not, I don't see it for them. No. Sorry, not sorry. Now, let me get back. Let me finish up y'all comments and then I'll get back to the book. So Marvin said, I love my cleavage and my thighs, but I would have taught my daughter to be classy and not a heifer hoe. But see, here's the thing. What the white women who walk around in what we used to call halter tops and short shorts, were they heifer hoes? No, that was a white woman existing freely. But you look at a black woman dressed the same as a white woman and suddenly she becomes a heifer hoe. That's what I'm trying to tell you, Marva. That's the shit that's put on us. There's a woman does not have a loss of virtue, a loss of worth, a loss of value because of how she chooses to dress. No. Because if you put a white woman in a skimpy sundress, nobody thinks she's a heifer hoe. No. But when you put a black woman in, all of a sudden she a slut, a bitch, a hoe, and she sucked dick. No. No. That's the shit that's been inculcated into us. That's why I said it is very dangerous how you think sometimes. Not you, Marva, because I understand why you think that way. But I'm saying how black women think, the older black women that are responsible for passing down the life lessons, they either dead and gone child or they just have got to the point where they like, listen, these bitches ain't listening, so I'm through talking. But it is not right to assume that because a woman has on, you know, short shorts and a halter top that she's somehow a hoe. That she's somehow a stank hoe, a skank, or any of that. No. That she's somehow not classy. Okay, Marva, then you got an even bigger issue. Because you think that somehow a woman is less classy because she's not wearing an A-line skirt and, you know, a ruffled blouse. No, ma'am. No. That's not true. Everybody wants to enjoy some summer sun. You know how many rich white women walk around in short shorts and a halter top in the Hamptons, whether it's the Black Hamptons or on Martha's Vineyard? Like, are we serious right now? Like, and I don't want you to take what I'm saying personally because it's not personal. There are thousands and thousands and thousands of women who think exactly like you're thinking. I know you didn't say it, Marva. That's what I'm saying. Don't personalize it because it's not personal. Child in a Oh my God. Let me stop because anyway. Let me stop it because no God. All right, so Kim said, I hate when people say and do that or be like, she fast, like the girl is 13 and the boy, excuse me, man, 25, and they absolutely, absolutely Kim Cash, because it's just what's been put into us in our youth. It's what our ancestors had to bear, and they just passed the fuck shit down to us. They it's like they got to a point where they got afraid to tell us the absolute rot gut truth, which is that these men lack impulse control. Funny. Oh no, that's a whole other conversation. We'll have to talk about this at another time. Let me get back to the book because yes, they both need to be taught. Okay, so Kay said, I was so upset about these kids that went downtown in Chicago a couple of months ago. I was like, where the hell is this child? Probably at home getting high. Shit, you know weed is legal back home now. Well, I'm not in Chicago anymore. And I miss it. But now that weed is legal, it seems like everybody's losing their mind. I don't even understand, you know. Oh, child, listen. I don't even yes, Audible could definitely never and would never. Well, you say you don't go to that mental ward Walmart. Listen. Oh. Yeah, I did. I snuck in and you did. I sure did. Okay. So I don't actually I listen. No, I really think they're very classy. I like them. I do. I love me a good A-line skirt and a ruffle blouse, but I also love me an old nasty piece of halter top and short shorts. And I'm sitting here now in a tank top and some booty shorts. I know you lying. No, God. That's what I'm saying. You know, it doesn't matter what you have on. You can still be classy. Classy has nothing to do with how you're dressed. It's about how you carry yourself, you know? And Kay said, because the wagon we dragging is deemed inappropriate for some. Absolutely. Absolutely. But they all wish they had that very same wagon, right? Because their men are definitely attracted to it. But black men would have you believe otherwise, that don't nobody want you but an old nigga, fag nigga. No, God. That's a lie. That's a lie. But I don't give a fuck what ethnicity of man you're contemplating getting with. You better vet his ass. Do you hear me? You better vet him like he's applying for a position with the alphabet boys, goddamn. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you can know a motherfucker for half your life and wake up and instead of Dr. Jekyll, you got Mr. Motherfucking Hyde. Okay? And trust me, I said it the right way. Everybody thought Dr. Jekyll was bad. No, it's Mr. Hyde that's crazy because he the motherfucker that put the face on in the first fucking place. But anyway, stay out my goddamn business. The whole idea, though, is this. For whatever reason, it's not white women telling black women how to dress, it's other black women. Now, dig that. Older black women tell you what looks slutty and what doesn't. But back in her day, somebody told her, somebody older told her what looks slutty. Don't matter. A man should always be able to keep his fucking hands to his fucking self. And I'm sorry to those of you on the replay that you got to listen to all of this, because no God. I'm sorry. And listen, I'm gonna be the Rand Marvin from over here, honey, because she's gonna take what I'm saying personal and think I'm talking to her. And I don't want her to do that, child. Because Marvin will be like, you know what? Fuck you, Saki. Fuck you and the speakeasy. I'm out, bitch. Child, listen. Let me. It's not personal, child. It's really not. Because there's you're not the only woman that think and feel the way that you do, child. Trust me, there are millions and millions. So yeah. All right. Let me get back to this book. I'm sorry if you're on the replay going, what the fuck? It just happened. Oh, Lord have mercy. All right. So, oh, I know where I left off. Here we go. He handed her the paperwork in his hands. I think you're fine the way you are, but if you want to hear, there's a surgery that can help. I've been considering it for years, and I have the money put up. You're chasing behind Messiah, but I want you chasing your dreams, baby girl. You can go to college. You can do more than flaunt around this town. Flint isn't the kingdom it used to be when your daddy was running things. It's the Wild Wild West, and I don't want you caught in the crossfire. Just think about it. Let me know what you decide. Morgan looked down at the paperwork, and when she raised her eyes again, Ethic was gone. For years, she had wished for this. She had never thought it could be possible, but as she sat on her bed and flipped through the pamphlet, tears came to her eyes. Messiah would have called by now if I was normal. I scare him. I scare everybody, she thought. She'd always been the girl who got stares. It's because people never saw a girl so pretty, her mother used to tell her. Morgan knew better. The stares were caused by misunderstanding. They were from discomfort. She was the pretty girl who talked with her hands, who had no voice. She was tired of being that person. She knew before she ever read one word of the information that she would go through with the procedure. She hoped the world sounded as beautiful as she imagined it did in her head. Most of all, she hoped Messiah's voice was as deep and strong as she suspected. She wanted to hear him say he wanted her, and even if he didn't, she had to hear his denial of her to believe it. And there's a break in the chat. Let me have a sip of coffee, child. Oh, Lord have mercy. This is why I tell y'all the speakeasy is not for everybody, child. Because I don't want an echo chamber. I definitely don't. But I don't need people to take it personal when I start, you know, telling you about where your antiquated, outdated, and outmoded ways of thinking and feeling and believing come from. It's hard to believe. It really is that, you know, people who were supposed to love us and care about us, they put things in us that now cause us to wrestle with a sane idea that somebody presents. And it's okay. It really is. It's absolutely okay. You know, I don't expect to have people, you know, agree with me 100%. I don't want an echo chamber because that's fucking boring. But I also don't want people who can't handle, you know, a good healthy dose of truth. Like sometimes you might just need to sit back and say, let me toss that around, you know, like a salad. Wait, it came out real wrong. Let me toss it around like meatballs and spaghetti. How about that? Okay. Tossing a salad has a different meaning nowadays, but anyway, my point is you take it, you toss it around. It's just about perspectives. You know, we all have different reasons why we think and feel the way that we do. And I just want to present a different perspective. I'm not saying it's required that anybody walk away thinking exactly the way I do. Because quite honestly, I don't give a fuck what people think. I only care about what I think. And if I'm wrong, then allow me to live in my wrongness. And if you're wrong, I'll allow you to live in yours. I don't give a fuck. What you do doesn't harm me. And what I do doesn't harm you. You know, I like for people who can put their grown drawers on, right? Drawers, not panties, not boxer briefs, drawers. Put your grown drawers on, right? Because there's something about a good pair of drawers that make you say, you know what, I'm grown now. I'm not talking about that cute little frilly poo-poo shit from Victoria's Secret that have your crotch itching. It's supposed to not, but the fabric is the way it's, I don't know, they put too many fucking holes in it. It push up against you and it's like sitting on mesh or something. I don't like that shit, okay? That shit stay on me for about 5 minutes before somebody rip it off. But that's a whole other story. Stay out of my goddamn business. But you can't walk around in that shit all day, okay? Just like you cannot walk around with outdated and antiquated ways of thinking and believing. Okay, so when you put your good drawers on, you know what I'm saying? Because you don't go to church in Victoria's Secret unless you're going to be doing some freaky shit in the parking lot or in the basement, you know what I'm saying? Depending on what type of pastor you got. See how it never ever stops right there? My point is a good pair of drawers, put your good grown folks' drawers on and entertain the thoughts of somebody that doesn't think exactly like you. A lot of people on YouTube engage in this fucking superficial bullshit, right? They keep the conversation real surface level. That ain't what you're gonna get over here. I wanna know what's going on in your cranium, right? Way down deep. How did you get to thinking the way that you think? And everybody can't handle that. They like to keep it surface, keep it real messy, you know, a little messy, whatever. Or let's just talk about the books, but a whole lot of real life is buried right here in these fucking books. And everybody can't handle that. So I understand, you know, if you need to dip out and not come back, it's cool. Ain't nobody gonna be mad at you. Ain't nobody gonna hate you. I see you when I see you, wherever I see you. You speak, I speak, we speak to each other. And that's it. The speakeasy is not for everybody. Everybody can't handle the way I give it up. And it's not that I'm being mean or rude or even, you know, I'm not being... I'm just being me, and that ain't gonna fucking change. No. No, it's just her draws are irritating. Like it's like it's I don't know. It depends on what type of, cushion you sitting on. I have a lot of cushion, and the mesh, it kind of makes it kind of sucks the cushion through, if that makes sense. It's like the little meshy shit. I would just prefer a pair of leather panties, okay? Stay out my goddamn business, okay? All up in my business, Jack. I mean, I just need, at least to be able to handle the fact that everybody doesn't think, the way that you do, and it's okay. And we don't have to be arguing in order to, express a difference of opinion. And you said it's easier to agree. No, see, I disagree with that. It's not easier to agree because that's the reason why the world is as fucked up as it is. Everybody just running around agreeing with everybody. I don't want to shake shit up. Not my ignorant ass. I come through the door with motherfucking Coke cans with pebbles in the bottom of them. I walk in the door ready to shake shit up. Y'all don't get to see that side. You see that over in the safe space, though. That's for damn sure. Fuck what you heard. Right. Y'all don't get to see that over here. Even this, I child, listen. Let me stop. It's too much for TV, YouTube TV. Because everybody don't want to be, keep it a buck and a bean. They keep it a buck and a bean about whoever their enemy is. They like to talk shit about whoever they doing battle with. I ain't doing battle with nobody but the bitch that I was yesterday. That's it. The bitch that I was yesterday, I do battle with that hoe because she's trying to stick around today. No, God, you gotta go. Every day, the old me has to go. The old way of thinking, even though it's newer than what it was the day before, right? That's my whole point. Every day you need to be growing and changing, and you can't do that stuck in the same fucking mindset. Everybody ain't thinking like that. Everybody don't want to face that part of themselves. They just don't. And it's okay. That's why I handpick the folks for the safe space. Yeah, you don't get to just come bopping up in that motherfucker. No. You can bop over here on YouTube, but not in the safe space. No God. I need folks that can understand that when I'm saying what I'm saying, I ain't saying it with any sort of malice, but it's still the fucking truth. And a lot of times that shit just hurts, no matter how tenderly or gently you say it. Y'all listen. The truth can have the weight of a feather, but can sting like a rag. And those sting rather good, I might add. But stay out my business, Kay. Okay? right, let me get back to this book. Child, this video is all fucked up. This is not how this was supposed to turn out. All right. Let me finish this. Oh, Lord Jesus. Love Jones. Where you at? How much time we got there? And don't you put no whole bunch of hours off up in there, because no God. All right. Messiah sat in one of his many cars. He was a collector of sorts. Old schools, foreigns, bikes. He had a thing for speed. Me too, Messiah. Where were you at? It made his adrenaline race. And as he sat inside the big body BMW rolling up, his music knocked so loud from the speakers that he couldn't hear his cronies wise cracking around him. He wasn't much in the mood for flexing, but he couldn't go into hiding. He had to be on the scene, following his normal routine to combat the whispers that he had been the hitter behind Lucas's murder. Niggas went into hiding after they got their hands dirty. Messiah was right there out in the open because he bore no guilt and wanted no implications, but his mind was a million miles away. Tupac was the sound to his life as Hail Mary rang out in the night air. Child, listen. Woo, that 808 on Hail Mary. Woo. Ooh, it's like a 4-5 to the chest when you crank it up real high. Check it out if you think I'm bullshit. The bass was so heavy that it rattled his chest as he nodded his head ever so slightly to the beat. The car wash was packed, and the night sky sparkled with stars as the city's finest pulled into the establishment for the simple purpose of being seen. Women walked by his car with no destination, just to give him a glimpse of their assets. They wanted to be chosen, and Messiah knew he had his pick of the litter, but tonight his mood was off. Thoughts of Morgan infiltrated his mind. To his own dismay, he had found her way, or she had found her way, into a place where no man or woman had ever been able to before. His heart. Not even his mother or father occupied space there, but somehow Morgan had broken the lock. He didn't like the distraction. When he should have been thinking about his next move, he was zeroed in on a woman, a young one at that. The tender feeling in his chest had him feeling like a sucker. He had seen how loving a woman had brought down the best hustlers over the years. His best friend, Noah, had gotten gunned down for thinking with his heart. Messiah refused to let the same happen to him. Love made men sloppy and unfocused. It was a weakness, and Messiah prided himself on having none. He lived a life of limited attachments because he always wanted to be able to walk away from everything at the drop of a dime. I'm already spending too much time on this, he thought. Messiah saw the thick crowd of people turn to look as a Range Rover entered the parking lot. Messiah knew who it was before the window ever rolled down. Only a few men had made it to foreign status in the city, and only one could cause such a frenzy when he pulled up. Ethics street resume was extensive, but he moved like a ghost, rarely coming into the city limits and choosing to enjoy his wealth silently as he masked a successful businessman. Retirement hadn't subtracted from his legend, however, and as he pulled onto the scene, it was like a celebrity had arrived. Ethic pulled directly in front of Messiah's car, blocking him in. He rolled down the window, revealing his stern face. Messiah turned down the music. Let me rap with you for a minute, Ethic's baritone announced as Messiah stuck his head out. Messiah knew it was an inevitable conversation. He knew Morgan was like a daughter to Ethic. He also knew that he didn't make the cut as acceptable to fit into Morgan's life. Yo, I'll be right back, he said to his squad as he exited, walked around to the passenger side of Ethic's whip. He climbed inside, and Ethic pulled away. Messiah wasn't fearful of anyone, but Ethic's presence was heavy as silence filled the small space between them. Do I even need to say it? Ethic asked. The authority behind his question was clear. Nah, I got it, Messiah replied. There is a line. She's on the other side of it. I ain't a bad nigga. You're not good enough for her, Ethic replied, with a stern tone that told Messiah that he was truly talking to a man about his daughter. There was nothing contrived or forced about Ethic's love for Morgan. Blood couldn't make them any closer. That's all facts, OG, Messiah responded. She's a special girl. Messiah looked out the window as they spun the block. I have nothing but respect. You've taught me a lot. You probably kept me alive over the years. You've given me game when you could have left me to learn it the hard way. I'll keep my distance. It's appreciated, Ethic answered. He popped the locks, and Messiah realized they were back at the car wash. That was all the time Ethic had to spare for today. Messiah exited and watched as Ethic pulled away. Ethic had the pipeline to the city sewn up. His trucking business was a legitimate establishment, but when something needed to come in or out, whether it be drugs, money, or both, Ethic ensured safe transport up and down I-75. The auto garage and repair aspect was simply a way for him to employ some of his old partners around the city and give them a legal means to an end. The real money was in what was coming and going on the semis. If Ethic wanted to, he could ice Messiah out and shut down all his blocks by simply restricting his access to product. Messiah didn't want those problems. It was best to let that go. He walked back to his car to find it swarmed with a pack of pretty women as his homeboys entertained. Messiah wasn't in the mood for bullshit, but he knew there was no point in turning down new pussy. He and Morgan were done before it could even begin. It was something he would just have to get over. He knew that Morgan was young and naive. No matter how mature she claimed to be, she would be a distraction, and he would be directly going against his big homie if he continued to pursue her. He pulled out his phone to text her and then paused. Ain't worth it, he thought. Hey, Messiah. The melody of her voice was laced with thirst, and he glanced up from his screen. What up? You need something? He asked, slightly irritated. Niche stood before him, looking like a winner amongst the crowd. She was a beautiful girl, and he could tell from the look in her eyes she knew it. He had seen her around, mostly with Morgan. She was young, freshly legal, so she hadn't been worn out around the hood. Shit. Yeah, that's what you think. He knew it was only a matter of time before a young hustler staked claim to her. I think she meant staked claim to it. Just you, she answered. Just me, huh? He answered as he shook his head. Bitches are dirty as hell, he thought. Where your home girl? He asked, checking her temperature to see if her loyalty to Morgan would stand up. Who? She asked, playing dumb. He smirked because young girls were bad at playing dumb, and he knew the girl before him wasn't playing at all. Morgan, Messiah played along. Oh, I don't know. I don't mess with her like that. We really more like associates. She's a friend of a friend. Why are we talking about her though? I'm trying to talk about us, she pressed hard. Messiah laughed at that. Another quality of young girls was their frankness. They hadn't been, or they hadn't perfected the art of flirtation yet. There's an us? There could be, she answered with a smile. Messiah had no interest in Niche, but he knew that if he took up with Morgan's friend, Morgan would lose all interest in him. Messiah knew it wasn't the best way to handle things, but he needed an out. He was afraid of the way he felt when in Morgan's presence. He knew, even with ethics condemnation, it would only be a matter of time before he went after what he wanted. The feeling she gave him was addictive, and he was craving her. He had to make Morgan hate him, because if she wanted him, the attraction would be mutual, and he would risk it all to make her his girl. He had to kill the possibility, and Niche was the perfect scapegoat. I don't know about all that. I ain't really looking for none of that. I'm more of a casual type of nigga, he answered. All fun, no strings, he said. He could see the disappointment in her face. She was looking for strings. She wanted to come up, but she would rather take what he was offering than nothing at all. Messiah hopped in his truck. You coming? He asked. Niche jumped on the opportunity without hesitation, climbing into his passenger seat. He rolled down his window to address his crew. Yo, I'm up. Y'all good? Yeah, we straight, one of his homeboys replied. Messiah rolled away with Niche riding shotgun and guilt pressing hard on his conscience. And that's the end of that chapter. I am just like, oh, come on, Ethic? Damn, you done raised this nigga practically. Why couldn't he be the one that was okay? Tell him if he just invest his money in legitimate businesses and make his come up that way, that it would be okay. Because all she about to do now is get that surgery and run towards this nigga, I'm assuming. That's the end of that chapter, child. All right. Let me get my time stamp for the next chapter, child, because this is Oh, my God. Chapter 8. Nanny, this pie doesn't make up for the $500 worth of free labor this man is doing for me, Alani said, as she impatiently waited for her great aunt to wrap up the homemade sweet potato pie. It's not about making up for anything. It just shows appreciation, Nanny replied, as she placed the pie in Alani's hands. Alani tried hard not to roll her eyes and pressed her lips together, stopping herself from getting too smart with the old woman who had raised her. I don't have time for this. I need to be at work in an hour and a half, she thought. Relax. You can't work $20,000 worth of hours in a week, Nanny said. She had always been intuitive. Reading Alani's thoughts was nothing new. I don't know why you're trying to work right now anyway. Your heart is broken, baby. Your daughter, your brother, they aren't even in the ground yet. And they won't ever be if I don't come up with some money fast, Alani said. I gotta go, Nanny, she said. I need to catch the bus to pick up a car before they close and then get to work so I can clock in on time. I'll see you tonight. Give him that pie. You always feed a fine man, Nanny yelled as Alani headed for the door. Alani turned around frowning. I never said anything about the way he looks. You a trip, old lady, Alani said, smiling for the first time in days. Yeah, all that sugar you put in your voice about how he was so nice and so understanding told me he was fine, Nanny shot back. Alani snatched her purse. I got your old lady, little girl. Ethic pinched the bridge of his nose in frustration. Wasn't used to his time being infringed upon. In the streets, he moved at his own pace. Even when he was a young hustler working blocks, he held some authority about himself. He was a one-man show and he got money without anyone expecting anything from him besides good product. Going legit meant that he had over 50 employees calling on him, depending on him, what seemed like every second of the day. It seemed like the boss was always needed, and he was slightly irritated that his day was being disrupted. He hit a U-turn in the middle of the street. "Daddy, where are we going?" Bella asked. "I have to make a quick stop," Ethic said. He saw her face fall, and he quickly eased her disappointment. "I promise. You know I don't break my promises," he said with a wink. She smiled and infected him as his lips spread in happiness too. His children were the only people who got to see his vulnerability. They were of him, composed of the same blood, his legacy, and the keys to his heart. He considered Morgan a part of that sentiment, which is why he expected so much of her. He pulled up to the shop. "Oh man, we have to come here. It's gonna take all day," Easy whined. "Big man, stop whining. What I tell you about all that whining? It'll only take a few minutes. Climb out," Ethic said as he opened the back door to his range. He could see that the woman was giving Redneck Larry a run for his money before he even stepped inside. Her mouth was moving a mile a minute, and a thick vein of discontent had appeared down the middle of her forehead, showing her frustration. When he opened the door, Redneck Larry said, "You've got to take it up with him." The white man turned to Ethic and blew out an exasperated breath. "The car isn't ready. There's a ton of more work that needs to be done, but we're closed, and I got to get home to the wife." "I got it from here," Ethic said as Larry gathered his belongings and rushed out the shop. "I need my car," Alani started in, bringing the static directly to Ethic. He found it amusing that she was demanding a rush on a car that was being fixed for free. He knew better than to point it out, however. Ethic wanted no parts of this mad black woman. The fire in her eyes told him that she would sear him alive if he did anything other than see things her way. He turned to look at the notes on the clipboard. It would be wiser to invest in a new car. The fellas have fixed the alternator, your starter, and exhaust pipes, but there's a crack in your engine block and the transmission is slipping. It'll take about 5 days or so to get all that repaired, Ethic informed. Even still, you're only putting a band-aid on it. This car won't last you another year. Well, I need every day of that year because I can't afford a new car. It was supposed to be done today. I was supposed to be at work 30 minutes ago. Is it drivable? She asked. If you want to break down a couple miles down the road, Ethic informed. She sighed the kind of sigh that only a black woman could muster. In the weighted breath, Ethic heard all her worries dissipate into the air. He hated that every black woman he knew carried too much on them. They were like magical beings that were expected to play 10 different roles every day, often switching them at the drop of a dime without ever missing a beat. He often wondered how they did it, how they pulled it off. And like you said, magic, motherfucker. We don't have a choice. Literally, the world doesn't give us a choice. The single motherhood of it all, the nighttime student of it all, the homemaker of it all, the lover, the friend, the chef, the nurse, the maid of it all. He knew she was a part of that magical melanin club because all black women shared that same sigh. He hoped his girls never had to learn it. She ruffled her shoulder-length hair, and he watched it fall back into place, each thick layer trained to fall at the nape of her neck because he suspected she was also a part of the wear a headscarf to bed club that black women had invented. It's bonnets now. It's an old school book. It's bonnets now, Ethic, sorry. She was a sister through and through, and Ethic drank her in. She was falling apart, and although he could see the devastation quietly creeping into her stance, sagging her shoulders and causing her chin to quiver, he still marveled at her. She was a mess. Her life was a mess because of him. But she was like a walking piece of mystique, and he wondered how she was holding it all together. "Where do you work?" Ethic asked. "What?" she responded, thrown off by the intrusiveness of his question. "You need a ride, right?" He felt obligated to fix something in her life. The car he owed her, the ride he owed her, it was the least he could do. "At a hospice center in Auburn Hills," she answered. "It's too far. I can't expect you to drive me 30 miles, and even if you do, I don't have a way home, so let's go," he said. "I'll make sure you have a way home. Don't worry about it." She frowned in confusion. "Come on, guys, back in the car. We're going to drop my friend off here, and then we'll get ice cream before we go to the movies. That cool?" Ethic asked. "Yeah," Easy shouted as he ran out the door. Ethic looked at Bella. "Yeah, I guess," she moaned, not thrilled with the idea. "No, you got your kids with you. It's really not necessary," she said. Ethic held open the door for her. "Get in the car," he said, nodding towards his truck. I don't even know your name, she said. I come up in here bitching and complaining after you agree to fix my car for free. Are you still gonna help me? It's nothing. I'm Ethic, he introduced, offering her his hand. This is Ezra, but we call him Easy. And that little girl with the screw face is Bella. Alani, she answered as she extended a dainty hand of her own. She handed him the pie box she had been holding. What's this? He asked as he took it from her hands. A thank you gift for fixing the car, she said. A pie. Do you like pie? I'm afraid to say no. Well, you come in here barking on my employees. I don't want to be on the receiving end of that mouth, Ethic said, smirking. I deserve that, she said with a small laugh. It's just been a rough week. I'm sorry for bringing drama to your place of business. I really do appreciate you working with me regarding my car. Thank you, Ethic. Her tone of voice was so sincere, as if no one had ever done anything for her a day in her life. In fact, no one had. Alani had worked hard, getting a job at a local restaurant, working under the table at just 12 years old. God damn! What? Oh my God. Okay. Nothing had been given to her. Not even a pair of panties was handed to her. She had earned everything on her own. She didn't have much, but what little she had attained had been bought off the sweat of her own back. This simple gesture wasn't so simple to Alani because Ethic was giving her what many people neglected to see value in, time. That's why I thank y'all for y'all time when y'all come into the speakeasy. You feel me? Because y'all could be anywhere else, but y'all be over here listening to me read these fucking books, talk shit about these characters, and the fucked up mythical black community that doesn't fucking exist. Back to the book. He took time out of his schedule to get here, or to get her to work, when he owed her nothing at all. Or, so she thought. She climbed into the passenger seat and admired the butter-colored leather inside. My ass even sinks into these seats differently, she thought, as she made herself comfortable. The sounds of Kendrick Lamar kicked through the speakers, not too loud as to draw attention, but loud enough to vibrate the seats she sat in. That's because the speakers are in the seats, man. Anyway, as Kendrick spit verses about being all right, Alani wished she could believe him. Her life was out of focus and she was stumbling through with tear-blurred vision. She knew she had been demanding, ungrateful, and downright rude regarding her car. And I know you said it's on the house, but I will pay you back every penny. I'm good for it, she said. He didn't respond. He acknowledged her words with a nod. Or was he nodding his head to the beat? Or was she killing his vibe? Or was Kendrick's words forewarning her to shut the fuck up and ride? She glanced in the back seat, noticing that the kids had fallen asleep. Your kids are beautiful, she complimented. Why the hell am I making small talk, she thought. His silence was so intimidating, so cold. He sat leaning against the driver's window as his graffiti-covered forearm extended to the steering wheel, his hand gripping the wood grain. His brow was set in a grimace as if he were in deep thought. One side of his face held scars and was hidden out of her sight, but she caught glimpses of it as they passed by city lights and it reflected against the window pane. The other side of him was flawless, so smooth and dark that it looked like he was made of chocolate. He was a mystery to her. I'm sorry, he said. He paused to clear his throat. About your daughter and your brother. You said you lost them, he reminded. He had to get that off his chest. His condolences came off as casual. He knew she would brush it off. How could he be sorry? He barely knew her. She would never know how sincere he was. Why? You didn't kill them. I'm sorry, she said, her myriad of emotions returning. Yeah, ma'am, he actually did kill them, but okay. She was angry and sad and lost and resentful. She was too many things to count, and she snapped off the words before she could stop herself. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to, she sighed. I just wish people would stop telling me they're sorry. Sorry doesn't do anything. It won't bring them back. It's just something people say when they don't know what to say. I'd just rather they didn't say anything at all. Or maybe they really mean it and you're just in too much pain to receive it. Either way, I don't say anything just to say it, Ethic answered. And even though she didn't know him, she believed him. Time passed quickly as the two let the music do the rest of the talking. When they pulled up to her job, Erica Badu was crooning about the next lifetime and it felt appropriate, as if this was a man she had run into at the wrong time, under the wrong circumstances. Child, if you only knew. Perhaps if they had bumped into each other in the supermarket or the mall, hell, even a nightclub, he might have taken her number. The weighted way under which their paths had aligned didn't leave any room for anything but sympathy rides to work. She was hesitant to reach for the door handle. He'd been nothing but kind to her, a true gentleman. She hadn't come across many of those these days. In fact, she couldn't even recall one. Even her daughter's father had been one of the bad ones, and although a beautiful creation had come from it, the scars he left behind still affected her to this day. She cringed at the thought of her child's father and quickly dismissed it, not wanting all the negative things she felt about her past to infect her present. Let me just pause for a second, because I just thought about something. Let me pull my soapbox back out and stand on top of it. Now, I'm sure this woman felt like her brother was just a troubled child, and it was somehow her fault that he ended up in the dope game because she didn't move him out. No, he had a fucking choice, that's first. But he also was a creep stain, ma'am. And little do you know, karma had given him a good dose of retribution because he raped a girl. Yeah. Bet you didn't know your brother was a rapey McRape pants. I'm sure you didn't know that, ma'am. So why are you all on TV talking about my daughter and my brother and my brother and my daughter? Your brother was a creep stain. And sometimes children, well, they suffer the sins of their fathers. And if her father was as big a bastard as you say he is or was, well, there you have it. And that sounds real fucked up. But when you understand how the laws of the universe work, I mean, you can pick up what I'm putting down. And if not, well, you do what you do and take it the wrong way or whatever. I don't even give a fuck. All right. Okay, so Marva said facts. The surgery is coming. This writer is something else. This could be a movie or Netflix series. Work? Her daughter just passed. Yeah, you'd be surprised. People got to do what they got to do. Nordic said, I love you, Saki. Listen. I don't give a damn how much you love me. I'm still going to be outside your job when you get off to kick off in your ass. Because you're the one that's got me reading this shit. I know you lying. Think you could tell me you love me and that's going to make shit all right. No, God. I'm still going to beat your ass because you got me reading this shit. And I'm bringing everybody in the chat to help me. You finna get a South Side stomp out, goddamn. Wait, that sounds real violent. I'm sorry, but I am gonna beat your ass though. At least I'm letting you know, so you won't be all surprised when you see me. When you walk out the door and I hit you with the sweet daddy from Good Times, oh wickle. Yeah, if you know, then you know. All right, back to the book. Daddy, I have to use the bathroom. Easy's voice interrupted them. I'll stop in a little bit, big man. Can you hold it? He asked. No, Easy replied as he began to squirm. He can come inside. There's a bathroom right inside the lobby, she said. She popped open her door. Thank you for the ride. You don't have to worry about getting me home or anything. I can call a cab or an Uber or something. Okay, well, this ain't too old because Uber was around. When the fuck was Uber put out? I don't know. You know, I don't know. I don't know when Uber came. I guess like you can always look and see if it came out. It don't matter. Alani had no idea how she would get home. Her accounts were overdrawn, and she didn't have a pot to piss in or a window to throw it out of. Every dime she had was going into the burial of her family. But no way could she infringe further on this man's time. He was nice enough just bringing me all the way out here, she thought. She climbed out of the car, and Ethic exited with Easy. I'll be right back, Bella. Lock the door and don't open it for anybody, he said. Dad, I'm not a baby, Bella protested as she placed her earbuds into her ears. Ethic didn't need a reminder. He saw her growing and changing every day, but to him, she would always be protected. Alani could see Ethic's disposition changed and she smiled slightly as she closed her door. Don't worry, all girls go through that phase. What is she, 12, 13? They crossed the parking lot and Ethic looked back at the car. She's 12. How did you know? He asked. She's just at the age where you're no longer the center of her universe. All dads get hit with the preteen curse, she chuckled. Don't worry, It'll pass. She's just looking for some independence. Easy ran ahead of them and opened the door for Alani. Ladies first, Easy said with a toothless smile as he extended his hand for her to walk by. Oh, so you're raising a little gentleman, I see, she said, astonished. She couldn't help but chuckle. Thank you. You are quite the charmer. He knows when to turn it on. That's all, Ethic said with a smile that was charming all its own. Alani drank him in. He was dark, brooding, and mysterious as he stood before her. He was perfection on one side, handsome with the perfect jawbone and skin so black, so smooth that he looked like a work of art. Then there was the opposite side, damaged and scarred, but filled with so much character that Alani instantly wondered what story accompanied the flaws. It was like God had molded him too perfectly and decided halfway through the process to even things out. There had to be balance in the world, and a man that looked as wonderful as Ethic's good side would be nothing but trouble without a little something to humble him. He walked inside the building with his son and Alani. The bathroom is right down there to the left, she said, pointing. Go ahead, Easy. Handle your business, big man. I'll be right here waiting for you, and don't forget to wash your hands, Ethic stated. He's charming until you find out he forgets to wash his hands. Wait a minute. Oh my God. She laughed aloud at that as Easy turned around and held up a bald fist, letting his father know he had overheard. I'm glad you find your tardiness funny. The stern voice that cut into their conversation was one that made her cringe. Her boss, Mr. Taylor. Alani turned, embarrassed that her boss was about to chew her out in front of Ethic. I'm sorry, my car's broken down, and I told you about the situation that's going on with my family. I got here as soon as I could. And you can walk right back out those doors, Mr. Taylor replied. Alani's mouth fell open as she shook her head in disbelief. Mr. Taylor, my daughter just died. I can't even afford to bury her. I need this job, she said, lowering her voice so that Ethic didn't overhear. Well, you should have thought about that before you let your shift start uncovered. Mrs. Smith has been laying in a soiled diaper for over 2 hours. Her family came here to find her soaked through the damn bed sheets. You know the policy. If you're going to be late, you get somebody else to cover you. You didn't even call. This is the third time you've been late this month. I'm sorry. I gotta let you go. This is exactly why I don't like to hire girls like you. Mr. Taylor, Alani shouted in protest as he began to walk away. She glanced back at Ethic and could tell he was purposefully trying to appear as if he hadn't overheard. She wanted to walk away, unbothered. She wished she was she oh, she wished she was too proud to beg, but she needed her job. She was already in a financial bind. This would only make matters bleaker. You can't do this to me, please. Tears were stinging her eyes as desperation filled her. I'll do anything, Mr. Taylor. He stopped walking and turned around. Alani knew the old white man would respond to that. He liked his girls fraught and vulnerable. He'd taken advantage of plenty young nurses by threatening them with unemployment or worse. Alani still remembered how one of her co-workers had sold her food stamps at work only for Mr. Taylor to find out and threaten to report the girl for fraud. The young girl had thrown Mr. Taylor some pussy just to buy his silence. Alani hadn't understood why, but she could more than relate now. She was willing to do anything just to keep her job. Ethic was uncomfortable, witnessing the scene unfold, and knew it was best that he saved her some dignity by leaving. He didn't want to make the situation any more humiliating for her. Truthfully, he should have already been out the door, but the word anything made him take pause. Was this beautiful sister literal in her meaning, or was he reading too much into it? He felt a nagging in his gut that told him to intervene, but he wasn't trying to get too close to this woman. He had wronged her, and to be around her but not inform her of the role he played in her misery felt like cruelty. He didn't want to disrespect her space. No mother should be subjected to the presence of their child's killer, and Ethic was just that, a child killer. No matter how handsome, how suave, how enlightened or appealing he was, he had taken her daughter from this earth. Intent didn't matter when it came to that fact. His bullet had ended her life, and despite the many lives he had taken prior to that fateful night, he was certain it was that one deed that would be his undoing on his judgment day. He shouldn't be near Alani. Didn't even deserve to breathe the same air as her. Still, he couldn't help but think, fuck she mean by anything? Easy came running out of the bathroom and Ethic corralled him, easing out the front door without as much as a goodbye. He led his son to his truck, all the while Alani's voice played in his head. I'll do anything, anything, anything. No woman, especially a black woman, should have to do anything to keep anything. But somehow every woman has done just that at least once in her lifetime. That anything that made them feel cheap, that made them feel dirty and worthless, always seemed to be just the thing that kept the lights from being turned off and kept the bellies of nappy-headed boys and girls full while their mothers' bellies growled through the night. Lord have mercy. Children rarely knew of the sacrifices their mothers made, but the effects of them were forever burned in the minds of the women who had to make them. Black women made ways out of no way by pulling that anything card. Even though it wasn't Ethics' place to intervene, he couldn't and wouldn't pull out of the parking lot as the white man inside held his privilege over Alani's head. As a black man, wasn't it his place to protect a queen who had forgotten how worthy she was of respect? This was the part of life that still puzzled him. How could he bask in his regality in this instance, but then take arms against his brother in another? It was in these moments that he knew that he was still victim to the conditioning of a society that made him feel justified to kill Lucas, but feel obligated to protect Alani. Was the life of a black man not as valuable as that of a black woman? Perhaps Ethics should have spoken to Lucas, man to man, educated him, forgiven him, brother to brother, perhaps. Ethics didn't know how to change his perspective. All he knew was that he had ridden to protect his. But this overwhelming desire to protect Alani meant she somehow was his as well. They belonged to the same tribe, the same black-skinned, dark-hearted Afro-American tribe. They were all the same, all only a few generations removed from the ships that brought their ancestors over here in chains. So yes, that black woman who was inside doing anything for that white man was his. This meant Lucas had been his as well. Same skin, same tribe. Yet Ethic had done exactly what society had bred him to do: exterminate blacks, hate blacks. So, did he hate himself? Same tribe, same skin, same nigger. Damn niggers. And I say that shit like it's cool, he thought. He had said the word so much that he no longer valued a black man as a human being. Lucas had just been another nigga to him. It was a different spelling, and he had tried to fool himself into thinking that it meant something different, but the word ultimately had always been the same. That was the illusion. That was the point of it all. While niggas were busy killing niggas, white men, like the one inside, was busy taking advantage of the black queens, and Ethic had fallen for the banana in the tailpipe. Confusion plagued him. Angst tightened his belly. He could not just do nothing. He had to do everything to stop Alani from doing anything. Hop in, big man, Ethic instructed. He looked in the back seat at Bella. Watch your brother. Lock the doors. I'll be right back. He felt the burner inside his shoulder holster beneath his jean jacket and walked inside. The lobby was now deserted, but he followed the fluorescent lights further into the building. He opened door after door, finding patients sleeping quietly behind each one and cursing himself for ever walking out, leaving Alani in the first place. Ethic was normally controlled and collected, but his own thoughts tortured him. He had put her in this position. She was in a desperate state, trying to bury her family because he had taken them away. The guilt was heavy. And as he pushed open a door at the end of the hallway, only to find it locked, he knew he had found the right one. Ethic knocked on the door forcefully with a flat hand. His temper was raging and his nostrils flared slightly at the thought of what was happening on the other side of the door. I'll be out in a minute. Whatever it is, handle it. Ethic heard the old white man's voice, and it was all the motivation he needed to plow through the door. He rammed it with his shoulder twice, causing the hinges to break as the door flew open. Her tear-filled eyes as she knelt in front of the man, the sight of his belt buckle undone as if Ethic had interrupted just in the nick of time. Ethic drew on him and placed the gun point blank on the man's head. You ever put your hands on her again and I'll kill you, Ethic threatened. He didn't yell, but his eyes burned with so much conviction that he may as well have been shouting. The man held up his hands. I'm sorry. Just go. Ethic wanted so badly to curl his finger on the trigger, but instead he looked at Alani. Let's go, he said. Her reaction took him by surprise as she pushed by him with anger. Mind your goddamn business, she snapped through gritted teeth, not sparing him a ghetto girl neck roll as she rushed down the hall before disappearing into the bathroom. Ethic blew out a sharp breath in frustration. He had never understood black women, when they should be appreciative, they showed anger. When they should be happy, they cried. When they should be sad, they were frustrated. Black women were anomalies to the black man. No matter what they did, it always seemed to be the wrong thing. And now he had to go about figuring out what he had done wrong when all he had were good intentions in the first place. Putting together her puzzle would prove challenging. He swiped his face with a hand of frustration as he was taken aback by her unexpected response. He went after her, storming into the women's restroom behind her. She was sobbing. As she stood over the sink, her head bowed in shame, she cried from her soul. Do you know what you just did? You took my job away. He's been coming at me for a year trying to fuck, trying to pay me for it. I always said no, even though other girls here jump on the opportunity to make the extra money. I said no until today. And you know why? Because I thought that my integrity meant something. I thought that if I stood for something, I'd be able to teach my daughter to stand for something. But then she disappeared right before my eyes. She's gone, almost like she never even existed, and I need to bury her. I'll do anything to make sure that happens. Even this. You just fucked things up even more for me. She was screaming, and Ethic stood there watching with sympathy. A canyon-sized hole filled him as he witnessed her undoing. She was drowning in an emotional flood that he had caused. Her turmoil, her pain, was the realest thing he had ever witnessed. It reminded him of his own, but he knew that her loss had to be greater. He had lost a woman, but she had lost a seed, flesh of her own flesh, blood of her own blood. It was like walking around with half of you in a grave. She was the living dead, as well as every mother who had ever lost a child. It was devastating to watch, and even more heartbreaking to be the root of it all. She gripped the sides of the sink so tightly as her shoulders quaked. She shook her head while tears wrecked her. When she looked up in the mirror, meeting his eyes in the reflection, his heart stopped. She was beautiful, her pain exquisite. What she had been willing to sacrifice was somehow heroic, and he was drawn to her. In the past, he had been pulled toward women because of their weakness, because he felt protective and felt obligated to save them. In this moment, he felt nothing but admiration for her strength. He wished his children had a mother whose love knew no limits, whose sacrifice had no boundaries. In her, he saw power, even though he could see her depletion on her face. He walked over to her, standing behind her, and wrapped his arms around her body. His height, his sturdiness behind her was what she needed. It was what every woman needed, a man to carry the weight when it got too heavy. Too many black queens were forced to play the role of king because of the absence of the men in their lives. Some man had put her in a position to parent alone, and now she needed someone to hold her up. She was left on stuff. Ethic couldn't leave her. Shock shone in her eyes as he stood behind her, holding her up, arms securely around her, as they both faced the mirror. I'm sorry, he whispered, as he lowered his face in the groove of her neck, inhaling her scent of honey. The way his strong arms cocooned her transferred warmth to her body, defrosting the cold that had set into her bones ever since the moment she found her daughter had died. This hug felt life-changing. Suddenly, it didn't feel like she had to stand up all on her own. He felt her legs give way as her body melted into his. She closed her eyes and exhaled as she wrapped her arms around his. Ethic's heart beat wildly in his chest when she turned around to face him, throwing her arms around him. He closed his eyes. Instinctively, he fisted her hair and tightened his grip as her face rested in his chest. He wanted to absorb her, press her so close to him that two became one, so that her pain became his. He barely knew this woman, but this moment was so intimate that it felt like he had been her rock all his life. Her cries pulled at his guilt, drawing it out of him like a syringe, and his eyes burned with emotion. Damn, he thought, the culpability of his actions mounting as he witnessed her grief firsthand. He knew he didn't deserve to touch her, but he held her tighter anyway because he knew she needed this hug. Let it out, he whispered. When was the last time she had been held like this? The energy she was transferring to him had been building up for a long time, and he accepted it all. They didn't know each other, but her need for him was transparent as she wept. He fisted her hair tighter, and the arm that circled her waist drew her in nearer. Everything in him told him to walk away, but he couldn't. She had him at hello. I'm just so tired, she cried. I know, he replied. Shh, I got you. He had no idea how long it had been since she had heard those words. He held her for a good 5 minutes and would have continued forever if the bathroom door hadn't opened, interrupting their moment. She pulled away as if a spell had been broken and cleared her throat as she frantically wiped at her eyes as another woman walked in. "I'm so sorry." Her embarrassment was evident. "Don't be," he said. "Come on, I'll take you home." She nodded and followed him as he led her out of the bathroom. They climbed into Ethic's truck and Bella was full of displeasure. "Daddy, you said it would be quick. We're going to miss our movie," she groaned. "I'm sorry, baby girl," Ethic said. He passed her his cell phone. "Look up the next showtime. After we drop Alani off, maybe we can catch the next one." Bella was like a whiz kid when it came to electronics, and she had checked the showtime before Ethic even finished his sentence. "It's in 20 minutes. There's a movie theater right up the street. Can we please, please just go to that one? It's the last showing," she said. Ethic found it amusing that Bella was suddenly championing for the kid flick when just moments before she had called it a baby movie. She just wanted Alani out of the car. His daughter was jealous that way. She didn't like anyone to come and steal her father's eye. When Easy piped up and joined in the debate, Ethic knew he had no wins. "Daddy, come on!" He looked over at Alani. "What do you say? You got time to catch a flick?" he asked with an apologetic smile. Alani peered over her shoulder at Bella and Easy as a small smile spread over her face. It was a glimmer of sunshine cutting through the dark clouds of her life. "Sure, why not?" she replied. "Finally!" Bella exclaimed, full of preteen impatience. "Yay!" Easy added. Ethic laughed as he winked at Alani, making her smile spread east to west across her face. "All right, Diary of a Wimpy Kid, here we come," Ethic announced. He was corny that way when it came to his children. He tucked his gangster away when in their presence because they deserved more than that. They deserved the very best. Not many people got to witness him that way. For Alani, it felt like she was peeking in on a private moment. So instead of staring at the marvel of a man in front of her, she looked out the window. Within minutes, they were pulling up to the theater and Bella hopped out of the car. "Grab your brother's hand," Ethic instructed as he watched them rush toward the door. "I'm sorry about this," he said sincerely as he opened Alani's door. "It's cool. I kind of love these movies. My daughter loves..." She paused and closed her eyes. Her heavy lids fluttered as she opened them. Fresh dew of emotion rested on her long, dark lashes. She was fragile. "My baby used to love them too," she finished in a whisper. Ethic's hand had a mind of its own as he brought it to her face to swipe a runaway tear from her cheek. He held out his elbow, a pure gentleman, and she held on to him as he said, "Come on, let's catch up before they order everything at the concession stand. I'll be out of $200 messing around with these high-ass prices." Alani shook her head and patted the big bag that hung off her shoulder. "Uh-uh, never underestimate the power of a black woman and a big purse," she said with a laugh. "I see your foreign truck and all that. I know you got it. That don't mean you gotta waste it. There's a CVS right next door. You give me $20 and I'll go grab all the snacks they want," she said. Ethic laughed, looking down at her in intrigue as she held her palm out and pursed her lips. He peeled off a 20 and placed it in her palm. "You're a genius." "I'm a mama," Alani responded. "I'll meet you guys inside." Alani was in and out of the store in 5 minutes. When she walked back over to the theater, Ethic was waiting outside. He held out his hand for her. She hesitated before she intertwined her fingers with his. Nothing had ever felt so comforting as she walked with him side by side, her bag of candy contraband tucked under her arm. Ethic's touch was dangerous. It made her feel everything other than what she should be feeling. When he placed his hand on the small of her back to lead her in front of him or grabbed her hand gently, it made butterflies flutter in her stomach. Even when their fingers graced each other's inside the giant popcorn tub, she sucked in air to stop her heart from leaping. She felt guilty for feeling anything other than depression at this time in her life, but she couldn't help but notice her attraction to him. He was strong, yet caring. And the vulnerability he showed with his children made her jealous that her child hadn't been anything close to that in her lifetime. She felt lucky to even be involved in this family outing because she had a feeling that Ethic didn't include outsiders very often. "Where's their mother?" she thought. "A woman would be half crazy to catch this man and throw him back into the pond." She found herself watching Ethic more than the film, when the credits played. Alani felt disappointed as the lights slowly illuminated the theater. They shined a bright light on her reality. This wasn't a date, and her life was in shambles. As soon as he dropped her off, she would have to face her daunting reality. She was saddened as she arose from her seat and followed the excited bunch out of the movie theater. She was quiet on the way home, and with his children asleep in the back seat, her silence was noticeable. The only time she spoke was when she rattled off directions, but still, she didn't even look at him. She peered out the window, watching the trees pass by in a blur as Ethic's foreign car ate up the miles on the highway. When they pulled onto her block, she was almost embarrassed to show him where she lived. He was driving a $150,000 truck while she was living in a $5,000 house that she had purchased with her income tax return from the land bank. It was far from glamorous. In fact, it was downright dilapidated, but it was home. It kept the snow and the rain out, which she had always been grateful for. This was the first time she had felt ashamed of it. Over the course of a few hours, his thoughts suddenly mattered to her. He placed the car in park and let the truck idle as he looked over at her. "Thank you for today," she whispered, "for stopping me. I'm the last person who deserves thanks," Ethic said, as flashes of her daughter dying in his arms plagued his mind. "I'm not judging. We can forget about what happened today. I'm just a guy dropping a girl off after taking her to a movie. That's what I remember from the night. How about you?" Alani gave a weak smile. "Sounds about right. I'll make sure your car is fixed by tomorrow at the end of the day," Ethic assured. She climbed out of the car, and when she was halfway to her door, she heard, "Alani!" She turned to him. "I like pie," he said, giving her a wink. She smiled wide at that before waving goodbye and rushing inside the house, upset that they hadn't met under different circumstances. Knowing that a man was the last of her worries, she shook him from her thoughts. The smell of soul food wafted through the house as she made her way into the kitchen. Nanny had left a plate wrapped in aluminum foil sitting for her atop of the stove. It was small comfort in the face of everything she was facing. It reminded her that there was still someone on this earth who loved her and someone for her to love. Without that, Alani would have surely curled up and died. She took the food up to her room, making sure to move quietly so that she didn't awaken Nanny. When she was behind the closed door of her bedroom, she opened the plate, sat down on her bed, and cried her heart away as she enjoyed a meal alone. And that's the end of that chapter. Ah, this is Oh my God. Yeah. This is crazy, child. But that ain't where you work, though. You ain't put that address in my DMs on Instagram. So, yeah, but I find you though. I know people that know people that know people that might know your people. I can find you. Child, this book is what time is it? It's 2:30. All right, so I'm gonna stop right here because Yeah, it is. I mean, I like him though. I hate how he met this lady, but I mean, you can't help but to like him. I mean, he's him. You know, but here's the thing though, as black women, child, we always want that dark, brooding, strong, virile, you know, I kill a motherfucker for my bitch type of nigga. Yeah, until they turn all of that shit around on you, child, one way or another. Yeah. You got to be careful, child. Because I tell you what, the universe gonna always give you what the fuck you ask for. It's gonna always give it to you. You hear me? All right. And thank you to the people who subscribed during this live stream. I appreciate you. I know I like Ethic and Messiah. Ooh, child, if I was 30 years younger, I'd be on some tag team. Back again. Check it to wreck it. Let's begin. Stay out my business, Kate. Listen, Linda, y'all need to stay out my business, okay? Y'all so nosy, always judging me. Man. All right, so listen, I'm gonna get out of here, okay? I appreciate you guys coming and listening to me read out loud. I'm definitely going to come back. I just need to go and I gotta go put this other load of clothes in the dryer now. What can I say? A woman's work is never done. But I did wash up the breakfast dishes before I came out here, and I'm gonna grab myself a little lunch or something, and I'll probably come back in an hour or so and try to give a little bit more. But these chapters are long, y'all. Yeah, they're long. What can I say? I'm sorry. I really Wait a minute, Kate, like I ain't even say nothing. I know you didn't, girl. I know you didn't. That's just I be telling everybody to stay out my business. I pick everybody. Anybody can catch me saying stay out my business, child. Listen. She like, I ain't even say nothing. What is she talking about? No, I be telling everybody to stay out my business. Child, listen. It's a joke, honey. It's a joke. Please don't take it personal. Please don't. Yeah, so I'm gonna make me some lunch. But first, as soon as I get out of here, oh, thank you, Marvel. Yeah. Oh, Lord. All right. I'm gonna make the thumbnail for the next live stream. As soon as I get off of here. And then I gotta cuss somebody out who told me they was gonna put me in time out. I saw your little message, ma'am. I'll put you in time out, socket. You fuck around, put me in time out. You gonna be doing time with me in time out. Watch out there now. Wait, did I just say that? My God. Oh, I did say that, didn't I? Lord have mercy. I have truly flipped my fucking lid. Where's the damn you dig at here? Okay, there it is. All right, so I'm going to make what time is it? It's 2:38. So what if I come back at 4 o'clock my time? And yeah. I'm trying to see. Yeah, I think that'll work. Yeah, that'll give me time to make a little lunch. That sounds so country. Make a little lunch. Yes. Kim Cash said, yes, come back at 4 o'clock. So yeah, I'm gonna make some lunch. So 4 o'clock my time is 5 o'clock for the people on the East Coast, 3 o'clock for the people on in the mountains, and 2 o'clock for the people out there in the wacky weirdo land of the West Coast. Okay. So yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. So I'm gonna set that up right now, okay? And then I will and I'll make sure to let y'all know. Yes, 2 o'clock weirdo time. That's right. 2 o'clock weirdo time. All right. So listen, thank y'all for listening to me read out loud. Thank you to the people who subscribe to the channel. Thank you for becoming a sipper or a speaker or both, child. And we got a few stoners up in here too. I don't judge nobody. Just make sure you pass. All right. Just make sure you pass and don't start no shit. And don't burn no holes in my couch at the back there, because that's the good couch. I'm still paying on that damn couch. Y'all always wasting shit in my speakeasy. Lord have mercy. I don't need no burn holes too, okay? All right, so let me go handle up on my business, and I will see y'all back here in a little bit, okay? Y'all please be careful, because I know y'all getting ready to travel the highways and byways of the YouTube first, looking for something to do until I come back. So y'all look both ways, please, and thank you. Because there's some loose drivers at the wheel, child. I love y'all. I want y'all to make it back here, okay? In one piece. I'm coming in the speakeasy with crutches and shit and full body casts and neck braces and shit because you done got run over by some loose ass YouTuber. All right? And listen. Thank you so much, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator, darling. I truly appreciate you and all your services. And fuck you for the $1 Cash App, asshole. And I will not. Okay? Thank you. All right. Listen, that was a personal message to somebody, y'all. That was a very personal. Listen, if you send me a $1 Cash App, I will be grateful to you for it. But for that asshole that just sent that $1 Cash App, fuck you and fuck everything you said. How about that? All right, moving forward. Listen, y'all go be safe, okay? And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. And make sure you keep an eye out for the thumbnail for the next video because I'm about to make it right now, okay? All right? Until 4 o'clock. Bye, y'all.